This is the Hagmann and Hagmann Report for today. It is a wild Wednesday edition. It's Wednesday, June 17th, 2015. We're coming to you live from the studios of the Hagmann and Hagmann Report here in Northwest Pennsylvania. Beautiful Northwest Pennsylvania, where it's overcast, cloudy. I guess overcast and cloudy, same thing, right?
Better a little than snow.
Well, yeah, that's right. And about 70 degrees, 74% humidity, winds out of the west. Oh, wait. Now that's my other job, doing the weather. I'm Doug Hagmann at the helm with fellow investigator, researcher, and most importantly, my son, Joe Hagmann. Together, we are the Hagmann and Hagmann Report, America's premier father-son investigative and reporting team. Folks, it's our job to bring you the news that propels the headlines, the news that is shaped and twisted, convoluted, and hidden amid a funhouse of smoke and mirrors in the carnival that we call the corporate media. We do the headline and news triage so you don't have to. We don't want to just thank everybody who has checked in with us from all over the world. God bless each and every one of you. For the new listeners, in fact, for some people asking what time the show starts and when we broadcast, actually on Facebook, on Hagmann Hagmann Report Facebook, just to let you know, we broadcast live every Monday through Friday from 8 to 11 p.m. Eastern Time. Our home base on the internet is HagmannandHagmann.com, and you can access us live there. And by clicking on the RSS feed, you can access all of our past shows. And of course, from our home base at HagmannandHagmann.com, you can access all of our social networking sites and, most importantly, our original investigative reports. Tonight, we've got a very special show for you. And before we get into the show and what's about to take place here, I want to tell you that we are, man, you know, just when you think life can't get any better, you just take a bite or a few, a handful of chocolate banana chips, as I did right before tonight's show. You heard me, chocolate banana chips. Tonight's broadcast is sponsored by Nature Box, folks. Nature Box ships great-tasting, guilt-free snacks right to your door. They've got over 100 flavors to choose from. 100, think about that, over 100 different kinds of snacks. And I'm talking like white cheddar, caramel popcorn, and chocolate banana chips, as I mentioned earlier, mini Belgian waffles, strawberry lemonade fruit stars, sweet and salty nut medley. I could go on. I can't wait to dig into the new bag of mini Belgian waffles. Joe, back away from the bag. Back away from the bag right now. Okay, thank you. All right.
How can I back away from it when you got it in a safe under your desk?
Any
valuables he has, he keeps in like a safe lockbox, but the Nature Box is in one of those safes that if it vibrates funny, it sends him a text alert to his phone.
I'm telling you, it's that good. Folks, you'll never get bored of snacking again. Try Nature Box for free. That's right, for free, by going to naturebox.com/CFB radio. That's naturebox.com/CFB radio or HagmannandHagmann.com. Just scroll all the way down on the bottom left there. Click on that, and that'll take you to our little world at Nature Box. And I'll tell you, take advantage of the free offer. You won't be sorry. And all of the snacks they've got, good stuff. Well, tonight, folks, I am so disturbed.
Our guest is with us.
Okay, all right. I am so disturbed tonight, today. And for the past really 20 hours or so, 24 hours, I've been disturbed, upset, prayerfully, and just prayerful for our brother, Russ Dizdar, his family. You know, folks, Satanism is real. The evil out there is real. It's unbelievable. The enveloping darkness of evil, which we all sense, is real. And most Americans and the majority of people living in the West seem to have lost their sense of evil, haven't we? Our moral compasses are just completely shattered, or they lack proper calibration, don't they? And why is that? Well, certainly the church, the Christian church, has seemed to go astray and is not recognizing the evil. Instead of recognizing it and fighting it, they're embracing it to a large extent. And we're going to be talking about that with our guest tonight, Mr. Russ Dizdar. Russ Dizdar from, his website is shatterthedarkness.net, but he wrote a book. Folks, you've got to read this book, The Black Awakening.
It is a must read.
Exactly. Exactly. It changed the way I look at everything. And I know, Joe, you too.
It's been a while. I mean, I read it twice, I believe, last year, and I have not read it since. And I have been meaning to go and get back into it. Because just like the Bible and other great works explaining the spiritual manifestations and times we live in, the more you learn and go back and read these books, and the more it speaks to you. Things jump out that you didn't recognize or see before.
And as we mature, too, in the Word, you can see things that Russ has brought to the forefront. Really. You know, and it's, indeed, it's, and there's so many resources at Russ's website. And folks, you can go to HagmannHagmann.com, click on the links directly to Russ's website. It's on the right-hand side, and also in the main article, I believe.
And with that, Russ, it's great to have you back on the Hagmann and Hagmann Report. I hope you're all getting settled, and I know you had a busy month, awkward month.
We've had kind of like a 6 months of stuff going on, and the last month has been the biggest. So the dust is settling, and we're glad to be with you guys. I hear your guys' voices, and you know, we've seen each other in person. You know, it just brings a smile to my face, because we have been through 6 months of some really amazing, crazy things. You might not know, we've been living in some hotels for almost a little over 3 weeks, because all of our stuff was put into storage. Everything got just absolutely messed up in the timing, and daughters going to the hospital, and specialists, and back and forth, and so we had everything in storage, lock boxed in, and we couldn't do anything for literally 3 weeks. So last Friday was my first day back to the radio. Last night or today we've done it, and this will be the first interview since all of that time. So we're glad to be back on the field. Dust is settling. God is good, but there's been some crazy stuff.
Indeed there has, Russ, and I'm glad we went through the move as well, the studio, the offices, and then personally, and I got to tell you, it's wow, it really kind of knocks you for a loop, and then you had the added stress of the timing and sickness. And
it seems like, Russ, in our past experiences, whether it's, you know, plane back from Montana, or you know, you moving your headquarters, you run into a lot of problems that are, you know, worst case scenarios for those types of situations.
Yeah, but you really
went
through that.
No. It was Montana was fantastic. 2014 was the greatest of years. I mean, we had 10 conferences and massive stuff occur. But starting in September, literally, is when it all really began. I was down for a month, couldn't walk, then had a boot cast and kept re-injuring it every time I did a conference. So this was going on. Daughter was going back and forth to hospitals and specialists, and that's still ongoing a little bit. But then this enormous upheaval of needing to move. I mean, it was a part of needing to. And then just being caught in the middle of, it involves so many different things. We don't have time to deal with that tonight, but, you know, in the middle of it, you know, God is here, and there's been, you know, we're on the field doing ministry to individuals, and a million, you know, just so many folks asking for the help. I know that's the way it is with you guys. So there's times that things occur, and, I had to really take care of what was happening here with my daughter too. There was a number of times right before the show where she had to go to the emergency, and so we had to pull out and go over there. But we're up with part of our equipment, and we're going to have all the new equipment as soon as we can unload everything. We've gotten 5, I think, truckloads so far of all of our stuff here. We got about 3 more to go. But other than that, listen, thank you for the prayers. I've just now seen the article you did. And then this week, this crazy guy from out west you know, makes his appearance in public declarations, and it was pretty pretty interesting of the timing too. So,
Russ, if I can ask,
here we are.
Yeah, you know, and ladies and gentlemen, I had no communication with Mr. Dizdar before I published that article at HagmannandHagmann.com. Russ, I debated and I prayed and I just worried and you know, I just sought the Lord's guidance. When I saw that video, I was not even going to legitimize it by acknowledging it and, you know, posting a link to it. And just suddenly something told me, look, do it because there are so many intercessors and prayer warriors. It seemed to, it was already taking on a life of its own before, but it's, you know, with the intercessory prayer and such, but it seems like I can almost feel a frustration of the self-proclaimed warlock, if you will, by the prayers. And that's why I posted a link to that video. I hope people can see that for what it is, because you're in the line of fire. You're being targeted specifically, and this is no game. This is not a parlor game of shoots and ladders. This is something pretty significant.
Well, in for those who didn't even know, we've had ritual warfare stuff done, things sent to us in the mail. You know, we had over this last year or so, we had two letters come in from Salem, Oregon. They had chicken bones or some kind of animal bones, blood, some other things in it, some kind of curse. And the postmaster, you know, he's the one that was able to track it back to Salem, Oregon. We don't know exactly who sent those and exactly the nature of reasons. But, you know, we prayed those off and commanded anything, you know, there to be broken. We've had other things sent to us, things laid at a couple of our houses in the past and car and even our offices years ago. So we've had stuff, but this YouTube video of a guy with that black mask and, you know, all that he was wearing, it was pretty much a kind of voodoo, but then using the word Samyaza, that's from the Book of Enoch, one of the primary fallen angels, and then he includes the dress that he did, and then he's doing the ritual to a demon spirit, a Loa from the voodoo venue of spirits and demon gods. So he really was, but what I guess caught my attention was, you know, it's like he knew the day we were moving in. He did it on the day and mentioned the day we're moving into the the new place. And then he mentioned my own daughter by name, which, you know, that's, it's one thing, you know, deal with me, you know, but, you know, do that. And I'm going to respond in every single way. But the neat thing was this, Doug and Joe, the great thing was that when we put that up and put that out there, now this individual probably in all of his life has never had thousands of people praying for him, praying against his demons and praying all these things. I mean, first of all, God knows what he did. He's standing there cursing and doing stuff that would seek to create harm and destruction and things to believers in Christ. And, you know, Paul and Saul of Tarsus, when he went after believers, you know, Jesus engaged him, brought him down to his knees. And Jesus took it personally. He said, you're persecuting me when you're doing this. So those who do this worldwide, believers all over the world that have been, you know, really physically persecuted and homes taken from them. But then there's these kind of things. And this individual now has made it known also that they're into blood sacrifices. I don't know who this person is, but the neat thing is individuals in law enforcement and other techs, they're going to track them down.
Uh-huh.
Because they believe it's a credible criminal threat. And, you know, there's law enforcement people that we know that are very versed in the occult world and written books on it themselves. They felt it was criminal. So there's going to be a reaction ultimately in an uncovering of who he is. And no doubt maybe he's listening tonight. Listen, take the mask off. You want to talk face-to-face, you want to engage face-to-face, be glad to do it. To hide, though, that's what they do, doing it in darkness, doing it cloaked, very much like the dark side overall, when it brings attacks against people and does the harm. But man, I cannot but say thank you for the article. I just got to see it tonight, and the incredible hundreds of individuals that put up responses and prayers on my Facebook page. They even went to the YouTube video itself. You could look at the many responses individuals put up against the guy. So this guy has prayer all over him from all over the world. Maybe this will be a Saul of Tarsus thing where he's going to drop to his knees. If not, maybe it will be a Pharaoh thing and God will have to engage him in some other way.
Mm. Well, we certainly are praying for you and the hedge of protection over you and your family. And I noticed a few things about this and the timing of it, the personal nature of it, as well as the some other things. But bottom line here is we can only pray that for his eternal soul, and absent of any conversion, then of course. Well, you know what, Russ, you're just, I just want to say that, our prayers are with you and your family, and we are fighting the fight. And I'll tell you something, it's a testament. When you see something like this to me, you know you're over the target when you're getting flack, when it's made personal like this, and you've got so many people that are praying for you, pulling for you.
And we ask our audience to keep Russ and his family in your prayers as these spiritual battles and principalities in high places are going to continue to engage the people who are proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ as the time draws shorter.
Absolutely. Russ, take us wherever you want to go tonight. I mean, it just seems like we're seeing such a rise in evil satanic forces, darkness all across the world. And I'm not trying to be this isn't hyperbole. This is just observation. And, I don't even know where to begin. I listened to your last show last night, and I think it was last night. Yeah, it was last night. I think the 15th. Yeah, that was yesterday, or 16th. I think it was either last night or the night before. Anyway, having said that, where do you want to go tonight with the topics and everything that's taking place?
Well, I think touching on this subject right here, and this is something I've really screamed out over the last few years. You know, spiritual warfare, and I've been a pastor also locally for 30 years before leaving and doing all of this full time, and all the conferences and all the things. I'll keep saying it: the overwhelming majority of the body of Christ are not spiritually warfare versed. That's a concern. As a pastor, as a Christian, discipleship is not there in the level. I mean, it's good to know some parts of the Bible, but the goal is to know all of it and to be equipped in every single way, awareness and alert and authority and armor, we mention all the time. So this is vital for believers. You know, the Word of God is very clear in what it teaches on the subject, and this is the world of reality. I mean, the entire issue, the last days, everything that's going on has a spiritual component. Whether you look at the political side of it, what's happening here around the world, you look at the Middle East, you look at the border, you look at the drug trade, you look at human trafficking. On a global scale, the biblical revelation is that the dark side continues to rise and push to bring about a synchronized, organized, focused agenda. It's operative. It's clear. Now, without eyes lit by the Spirit of God in Christ, I don't know how anybody's going to see this. They're going to see all kinds of it's like trying to Band-Aid the cracking walls of the Hoover Dam. And humanity, the Band-Aids are running out, and people moving further away and backing off is not the answer. What's the cause? So the cause on a global scale, the cause in our personal lives is very clear in Ephesians 6. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against these principalities and powers. Now, in my personal life as a believer, in everybody's personal life, we're saved and we're brought out of Satan's dominion into the kingdom of Christ. We are, the chains of Satan is broken, but it doesn't mean that he's not going to send his arrows or bring attacks. The other side of the story is the level of occult warfare. And this is what Israel experienced in the Old Testament. When we go back and revisit Israel, they were fighting nations that were highly demonized, that called on demon war gods, that did blood sacrifices to demons, to the demon gods for powers on their soldiers. They weaponized them. Human sacrifice was a massive thing in the Old Testament. The constant hidden underground Luciferians would continue to do everything they could to bring it right down Israel's neck. And the ritual powers and the dark powers were absolutely real. And if Christians don't understand how real it is, they've already lost half the battle. And not having the biblical, what is the Spirit of God? What does God want us to be equipped with? Authority, armor, and so forth. So with this end of days issue, there is no end of days without the spiritual component, the cause of the most radical, violent, wicked evil is satanic, demonic presence in the world, escalating, manifesting, operative. That's the biblical prophetic picture. Now, with that comes, well, like the wicked warlock of the West, an individual like that, he's light level compared to the undergrounders. And the undergrounders that know the ancient spell, you know, the ancient stuff, the human sacrifices on a large global scale, the ritual abuse, the chosen ones, that's like we're right in the middle. Starting the 20th of June comes the dates of abduction, all the way to the 25th, grand climax, the solstice coming up, big rituals all over the place, coming into July, Bohemian Grove, everybody knows about now. So the rituals that have been going on in really extreme hiddenness are being found out more and more, but I still think we're only touching the tip of the iceberg. You know, I've said this at conferences, and it shocks people, and they want to question me. I believe in the last 30 years, 500 million globally, 500 million types of blood rituals have been done, and they are now synchronized on a global scale, on a date basis and on what their, you know, agendas are. So the fact is more blatant, the babalaos, the santeros, the poleros, the voodoo, you know, mambos, they're all, I mean, the satanic magus and sorcerer and priests, they're going to come out more and more. They're going to be coming out like in the days of Elijah, the prophets of Baal. They're going to come out in challenging. They're going to come out very demonstrative. So I'm saying that Christians, we've been given all the armament in a superior sense, in a extremely, we've been covered in every way, but not knowing it, not appropriating, and not using it leaves the believer in a very tenuous and weakened condition. And it allows darkness to suppress the church and push it backwards and to crowd over it. So as you mentioned earlier, Doug, the church, instead of becoming and demonstrating its incredible possible powers and its witness of the living Christ, like in the book of Acts, blindedness and suppression and holding back has allowed the dark side's agenda to go almost, in a sense, uncontested. I mean, I don't know of any church on a Sunday morning that in the middle of the 18, 20 seconds of prayer that it's averaging, I don't know of a church anywhere that stands and prays against real dark powers in the city, that it's part of the drug trade, part of the violence, part of the heroin trade, part of all that's going on. So we're not using our weapons. We're not knowing our weapons. And the church can be astoundingly powerful in this day and hour, but we're seeing you know that we're missing it and to the detriment of many others and to the advance of the dark side.
Russ, I don't know if you saw this story. You made reference to these types of rituals taking place, but Dominique Strauss-Kahn. This is a headline from The Guardian. Dominique Strauss-Kahn verdict due after trial hears of beast-like orgies. And it goes on to say that the former IMF chief fund, Kahn, told the French court that he participated in sex parties reminiscent of orgies in antiquity because he needed recreational sessions while he was busy saving the world from one of the worst financial crises. The fact that this is in the media also, we're seeing more of these ritualistic, sex slaves, sex trafficking stories make their way to the public eye. Do you see that as an indicator of anything? Or 'cause usually this stuff would have been kept in the dark, from my understanding.
I think it's like, I think it, because... because now there's just simply so much of it. There's just too much, and it's leaking out everywhere. When you go to England, and now you find the massive scandals, and you find the Jerry Saviles and so forth that have come out. You can go to Pennsylvania and look at Jerry Sandusky. And though they touched on the pedophile side of this, I'm saying again, this goes much deeper, so much more deeper than just the when that's bad enough alone. But then this story, too, and many others, the one in Mexico just lately with the Catholic Church pumping in exorcists and so forth, and they want to exorcise Mexico now. of the demonic presence, because they're recognizing how vast it is. So, no, I think Joe, you're right, because the elitists, this is the kind of like the Eyes Wide Shut stuff coming out, and we're getting glimpses of it from people that have got, you know, partially caught, or they're testifying, or they're telling a little bit. It reminds me not just of the blood cults of Rome, the Tucatoriums, the elitist, you know, orgies, but many of these, like the Son of Sam issue there in New York some years ago, in Untermyer Park and so forth. It wasn't just the sex, although that was a central part, and kids involved, and a decadence of the sexual side involved, and ritual sex involved. And then you go a little bit further in the investigation, and you find that there's dark powers, and then you find, you know, who's really in charge, who's running this, you know, what's the intent? More corruption, more powers, more, you know, blackmail, you know, that's the Bohemian Grove stuff. So what we have seen in the last maybe a decade of the uncovering of some of the stuff at Bohemian Grove, as I said years ago, I believe that's only one high place in a network of high places on a global scale.
Wow. I mean, to hear it is, you know, it really kind of wakes you up a little bit into the people who think that this is just mostly fantasy. It's not. I mean, it's real. It's you know, man. Okay. And I look at your book and have read your book, and just the, well, Shatter the Darkness University, basically what you've done and how you've laid everything out. The ritualistic abuse of animal and or human victims subjugates them to prolonged and intense torture for the purpose of power and rewards. I mean, this is going on. The perpetrators believe, for example, they're going to receive dark spiritual powers and also physical pleasure. You know, and the laws that you have delineated, I think, what, five or six laws. It's not what you believe that matters. It's what they believe. And so on. I mean, you know, since the beginning, Fall of Man, history is full of satanic rituals, a human and animal sacrifice. And you had mentioned just tonight, 500 million, a half a billion. That just seems incredible. A half a billion.
And Doug, it does. It really does. And yet, like, we look at human, I talked to somebody here yesterday about human trafficking. Most everybody's agreeing, you know, we're seeing 25, 27 million on a global scale in this human trafficking stuff. But when it comes to satanic ritual abuse, which human trafficking and satanic ritual trafficking are intersected, we've been telling the groups for years, you're going to find kids coming in, they're going to have different personalities, they're going to have demonization, they're going to be acting out, they're going to be doing stuff. Well, we're hearing that from all over now. Everywhere we're hearing it from human trafficking directors, you know, of safe houses and places. So they're just going to be showing up all over because there's so many of them. We've mentioned again and again, the book is, you know, kind of the groundwork, but there's another 600 pages I need to write. I need to write badly concerning not just updating, but giving more of the picture. The book gives a really, you know, it brings in covering, but Joe and Doug, I want to say it tonight here. Like the rituals that are going to come up here, the 25th of June, the 27th of June, and specifically July 1st, when we deal with July 1st and then August 4th, demon revels and satanic revels. You know, anywhere there's an individual that was been through satanic ritual abuse, anywhere there is an individual, like in your city where they've been found and they're in psych wards or they've been in counseling, means that there's a coven behind their creation. You can't have them unless there's a coven behind that created them. And that coven is versed in the deepest and darkest of ancient rituals that go all the way back to Sumer. And this is the real stuff. This is the bottom of the barrel. This is the closest to hell's gates, other than Satan, you know, rearing his head. So when you have a coven in your city, and you have a coven in every city located around you. And when you find out that, and we've mapped this and we're continuing to map this, in every city, large and small in the United States, there are these kind of, let's just call them the real Luciferian, like Ezekiel chapter 8. Then when the one in your city does rituals on the 25th, 27th, July 1st, August 4th, and so on, so are the other ones. They're all going to do it. Anybody working with SRAs over the last 10, we've been doing it 30-some years, they're all going to tell you the same thing. They found out the same thing. These rituals are synchronized. They're on dates. They're, you know, and when they're doing them. So when they're doing them in your city and the cities around you and in every single city in Pennsylvania and every single city in Ohio, it's by design. They're being done in England. They're being done in Germany and France. And all the Aussies know this. And those in New Zealand know this. And in Canada, they know this. And so... you're going to have in the next month and a half, 2 months, you're going to have specifically, some of them are sex rituals, but there's also blood rituals that are designed that are going to be done. When they're done on those dates, they'll be done not just in your city. They're going to be done in every single city in the United States at the same time. Now, that's the kind of picture I want people to understand. Not to be afraid, but to rile us to I want us to have the David effect. When Goliath is on the field, the David effect is an outrage, ready to run right there into the to the arena and say, man, this is an outrage. We must stand in the name of the God of heaven and do something, because more kids will be sexually abused, more marriage to the beast ceremonies will go on, more kids in cages, more of all this is going to go on. And uncontested, it has just developed. And that is the biblical portrayal of the end of days, the rise of Babylon. If you read Revelation 18, you see this on a global scale, every city, every place. But I'm just letting you know, and I want all the listeners to know that it's not only so absolutely real, it's so absolutely numerous and growing. And when we put the book out a number of years ago, we were really writing about, we primarily dealt with the first generation, ritualized individuals. We got second, third, and fourth now. And so you have more now, and you'll have more next year than you do this year, but the numbers are beyond – it's hard to comprehend, Doug and Joe. I know it is, but that's the facts. This 25th of June, this 27th of June, July 1st, August 4th, anybody can look on the Satanic Ritual Calendar. Those are the publicized dates. And they do them all along anyway, but the big dates. So simultaneous rituals, multi-continental, every single city in the United States, it'll happen.
Okay, not that I – and I apologize for this. Please, Russ, tell us those dates again, okay?
Sure.
I just want to make sure I have this correctly because I think this is so important. Give us those dates again.
Sure. And here's what I would say, if anybody just wants to, kind of do a search on, and I would put it in this way, SRA Ritual Calendar. And there's a number of sites that now put it out. We put it out before, but that used to be something in law enforcement they had back in the 80s, and we knew about this, and then it eventually got publicized on the web. So if you look at the dates, all year long, you're going to see Hands of Glory, you're going to see Marriage to the Beast, you're going to see, Satanic Revels, Demon Revels, of course, Wall Purges. And so you can look at those dates, and here's what some law enforcement can do now. They can go back to where there was some kind of bizarre ritualistic types of killings and findings of bodies and so forth, and now you can begin to go back and say this corresponds with the date on those calendars. Like here in Deerfield, Ohio, little girl named Sarah, taken out of Rochester, Pennsylvania, and she was taken, brought over here, and she was stabbed probably 100-some times in a bloodletting ritual, sexually abused, and then killed, and then left in a field where satanic rituals were known. Now, that was the July demon revels, and then and satanic revels in August, a girl named Kathy Menendez out of Alliance. The reason I'm mentioning their names is because the feds had their faces and names on a big billboard on Route 62. So those dates were the dates they were slaughtered and killed. Now, even though law enforcement, I was taken to one of the department's chiefs of the police. I've been to five other departments to turn over, state's evidence on the individual, the group, and the motivations behind it. It's an unsolved, to this date now, 14 years later or so, maybe more than that now, they list that as an unsolved crime. But this is a girl out of your state and a girl out of my state. We know the individual, and this is the terror they went through, and then their bodies left in the field, and their parents. I met with their parents. I had to hunt down the parents. Now that's what I'm saying when I'm saying on those dates, those kind of rituals. So this month, the 25th, the 27th, specifically for the solstice coming up and grand climax coming up. Now, the 20th, starting the 20th, just a couple days from now, prior to these dates is what's called, it's when they're looking for ritual preparation, abduction of individuals going to be used in the ritual. Then you have July 1st. You have August 4th. You have demon rebels and Satan rebels. But again, the calendar will show you, if anybody looks it up, it'll give you the dates that have been out there. And those correspond to, thousands and thousands of ritually abused individuals that have come forward in the last 30 years all over, not just here in the United States, but Canada, England, Ireland, Australia, Germany, France, Italy. This is what I'm saying. If we understand biblical truth as Satan going global and a global, there's no globalism without the real powers. And the only way to get the real powers, their number one way is human sacrifice, to get their powers across. And on this side, and to advance, they can't advance this globalism without these powers. They can't get these powers without, they're number one. They've known this, this goes all the way back to Sumer. This goes back to Chechen Itza. The number one way to manifest demonic powers is human sacrifice, the shedding of blood.
Oh, man. Pretty heavy stuff. I mean, really, the two cases you referenced, one of the two I'm somewhat familiar with, and this is all too real. I mean, this is, people really need to understand what's taking place here, that a lot of what we see is organized, orchestrated, satanic in nature, deliberately done for the purpose of, for the satanic aspect of things. And it's, it's, okay, I get this. Should people be more, alert here in the upcoming days as we get closer to the 20th, of course, 3 days away here in the east, and then of course the 25th and 27th and July 1st, and I mean around these dates, what should people be more concerned, more alert, especially those people who are fighting in the spiritual war?
Well, I agree. Yes. Good thing to bring up, because, to know about, that's why, we read in Ephesians 5 about, we're commanded, the body of Christ commanded, expose evil deeds of darkness. Well, you can't expose what you don't look at. You can't expose what you don't know. And so Christians have been taught, look away. Don't talk about this. Don't talk about the devil, because that only glorifies him. That is so totally opposite to the Word of God's revelation and exposure of the devil and what we're told to expose. That's what God did in Ezekiel chapter 8, Doug and Joe. That's exactly what God did. He wanted it exposed to show, not to create fear among the people, but to show it's radically there and that we're to respond correctly. Now, you and I, we're in a spiritual battle as believers. You and I know that we, as just Christians living our daily lives, we can have the enemy, bring oppression to us and bring attack. Job had attack in his life. Peter, he didn't know what was going on. He's out there denying that he even knows Jesus because he's under spiritual attack and he didn't even understand it. Here's the advantage the dark side has. They operate in stealth. 2 Corinthians 4:4, the God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers, so they can't see. Now, the word blinded, that word itself means it's like throwing smoke. It's a real operative presence. We read the scripture so quick, we memorize it clearly, and that's great. But let's look at it again. The God of this, it's definitely referring to Satan. He's the God of this eon, this time period that we're living in until Christ comes. He's there to blind the minds of unbelievers so they cannot see. You look at the verse, first, again, 2 Corinthians 4:4, so they can't see Christ. They can't see Jesus, who is God in human flesh. Now, but we understand the goal of that, but here's the operating principle. Satan is actually, through operating spiritual presence and powers, blowing spiritual dark smoke, per se, on the minds of people so they can't see. They can't perceive. That word has the idea of there. I mean, it's not just a statement. It's not just words. Satan's not only real, but he has real operative powers. And that's what I don't think most believers understand. Now, a cultist and this warlock god that claims to be a warlock, though he's doing voodoo stuff, though he's doing, you know, I don't know what mixtures he has, but he clearly knows powers in his own way. He doesn't know who they really are. He doesn't know that they're going to rip him to shreds. He doesn't know that they hate his life. He doesn't know these things. He's sucked in, and so are those who are practitioners. But the fact is, they're real powers. And so when these dates are coming up, I always mention this to law enforcement now because there's a lot of cases that are related to this. A case in Akron where the girl had her hands cut off, hands of glory, was done the day before in order to get her hands. Nobody in Akron has found the hands of Wendy Snipes. Nobody's ever found the hands. They're probably on some ritual altar charged demonically. And there's cases like Sarah Bain and Kathy Menendez that have gone on for over 14 years unsolved. And the hard part is telling most of the law enforcement individuals, including the feds that we brought the information to, I would say it this way, completely dismissed, because in their forensic look at it, in the criminalistics of it, there's no grid. They don't have the grid that taught them, hey, the motivations for this crime is because a high-level Satanist who believes and knows these powers orchestrated the kidnapping of Sarah, orchestrated the kidnapping, luring away of Kathy. That the reason why they were stabbed 80, 90 times, little jabs, not all the way through, none of those little jabs would kill them. It was for bloodletting and causing pain and bringing the human energies up in order to bring the demons to attach to it, in order to bring the biggest amount of powers in and on that person. The little girl, 14-year-old Sarah, 2 hours she's probably going through this ritual, sexually being abused. In every way, they're trying to draw up the energies in every way to draw the demons in to attach so that when they kill her, which they don't even care, you know, of course they don't care about her, or her screams or her terror, so that the demons that have manifested in that human sacrificial ritual then would be sucked into or poured into the practitioner. So that's the motivation behind that crime. The person that did that to that little girl, Sarah, and did that to that little girl, Kathy, for the sake of, in their own words, to purify their blood, to get their pure blood in the Nazi sense back, meaning that they needed to cleanse their blood with demonic charging and powers. And the only way to do that, that kind of ritual that would bring that kind of destruction to a human being, that would draw that kind of real demonic power. Now, you said it earlier, and this actually goes back to the law enforcement agent, Tom Wedge, that said it in the police academy in Opata numerous times. It's not what we believe that is the issue. It's what these practitioners believe that make them so dangerous. There's no question the guy out west that did this believes in the dark powers and cursing me and doing what he did. He just doesn't understand the power of the blood of Jesus. He doesn't understand the power of our ability to pray back. You know, he probably sees most Christians don't even know how to do anything and are defenseless. But we know how to take care of this. In the case of these girls and the dates that are coming up, to be aware of the dates, to be aware of Satan's operating presence, to be aware that it's not going away, that it's going to get, there's going to be more of it, more is going to leak out in the press, on a global scale, in the among the celebrities, among the rock stars, in Hollywood. It's going to continue to leak out, and we're going to see pieces of it. But here's what I want everybody to remember. Behind the glimpses is a very deep, deep, deep dark basement of it constantly going on, where right now as we talk, there are thousands and thousands of boys and girls in the human trafficking trade, cages, rooms, and so forth. Also, the ritual abuse, you know, cages, and they're there, and they're being used and abused, and they've been participating. I mean, you could have 1,000 real SRAs call into your show tonight, Doug and Joe, and they can all tell you, and they might be coming from Canada, Australia, New Zealand, England, and they can all tell you of the stories, and they can draw pictures, and they'll shake and tremble and fall to the ground, and they're terrified, but they can all tell you of the blood that is shed, the humans that have been killed, the animals, the sounds. They can all tell you of the feeling of the demons as they begin to manifest in some cases, I believe, materialize, and as they're transferred. They can all tell you the stories. Multinational, multi-continental, as they're listening even now.
Russ, is there a hierarchy? I mean, obviously the head of all of this would be Satan himself and Lucifer, but is there an organized human hierarchy that's at play here? I mean, is it the Illuminati? Is it the the Olympians? Whatever. Or is this less organized than that?
No, I think you're right. You're right on the right road. I mean, again, this is what I love about. I mean, no matter how many thousands of books we can read and how many stories I can hear from individuals, biblical revelation is the most accurate and only infallible insight into all of this. It's very detailed and it's way advanced. It's already prepped us. So. When I look at this, I mean, we can look at when it comes to satanic ritual abuse, sometimes they'll use a phrase, the brotherhood or the ancient brotherhood or the order. If you go back further to some of those involved in their 70s or even the originators in their 80s, which we just dealt with one of those guys this last weekend a little bit, we can talk about that without names. We're talking now the Nazis' term black flame. Now, this, again, is connected to, you can go back to, Weishaupt's version of the Illuminati. The reason I say real Luciferian, but what I mean by that is the description of the practitioners in Ezekiel chapter 8, where they're hidden, they're down in, they're serpent worshipers, they're blood sacrificers, they're doing it in opposition to the presence of God, they're doing it hidden and so forth. What we see in Ezekiel chapter 8 from a few thousand years ago is what I believe we're seeing on a global scale now, hidden and entrenched. If you say Illuminati, if you say Luciferian, if you say the satanic order, here's what I would say. From a biblical scale, 2 Thessalonians 2, the Greek word used, and we read it as the mystery of iniquity. It's the Greek word, the mysterium. There is a mysterium, a secretive, hidden, operating, organized, call it a system, call it a collective, where, sure, Satan, the demons, are the ones in charge, but there's a human, they can't do it without the human component. There is no New World Order without the human component. There is no Ten Kings that are part of the Antichrist's global system without the overall human component. So they got to manifest in and operate through the human component. So, I believe there is. If you say it like the tiers of layers of a cake in a sense, or if you look at some of the folks that have written about it, they will. I look at it as New Agers being very light level, but very, again, still radically spiritually deceived, very dangerous, because it pulls the, and I guess I would have to say now maybe a billion worldwide that are connected in some way to the New Age movement. That's the spirit of Antichrist. That's consumed in deception and masquerading hundreds of millions. Now, when you drop down the tiers of the New Agers, and then you can talk about Druids and Wiccans of all different varieties, pagans of all different varieties, Satanists in the public arena of all different varieties, but it's below that. When we go below the surface, we come to the mysterium. We come to the system that knows. Here's the categories. You can call them the Illuminati. You can call them the Luciferian. First of all, they know who they're in service to. They believe that he is the Lucifer. He is the light bearer, like in Albert Pike's Morals and Dogma. They really do believe he's coming as the good one. He's going to come, you know, even in the Devil's Bible written by Father Maradon, they say the same thing, that the Antichrist to come, Satan manifesting, is going to come as the shining one. So they really do, the real Luciferian, the real Illuminati, they really, really not only believe in him, but they believe in him as coming with a superior power, the bearer of light, in their sense, the one that's going to involve humanity. Now, they also believe that he's going to come and bring a world order, and they also believe that they're being drawn in to be participants. Now, all of the SRA individual chosen ones we've ever dealt with, they know that these powers are demons. They're not just ghosts. They're not just – they know that they're power demons, different types of demons, and they understand the structure of demons, and some are stronger than others. To them, it's powers, not only that they receive, but they have to let come through their rituals to extend into society, to come against, you know, they're targeting churches, they're targeting pastors. This guy, this warlock, you know, targeted us. He's not the first one to do it. He just went public with it. Doug and Joe, there's no question, you know, you're going to be targeted. So when you ask about that, I would say the biblical term mysterium in 2 Thessalonians 2 describes the global collective that has Satan as the operating force behind it, but the people involved are very, very similar to the Eyes Wide Shut folks, the Bohemian Grovers. Now, when I say Bohemian Grove, which is coming here in July again, I don't mean the people that set the presidents and senators and media moguls and military men and world leaders. That's one thing. The bigger issue that's not being addressed is who has the power and the clout to bring them there. That's who the real Luciferian is. Those who are the what are called sorcerers and maguses, these ones that are really deeply, you know, deep practitioners, these are the ones that are really in the shadows. If anybody knows how to stay in the shadows and have powers to keep them hidden, they are the ones. So behind Sandusky, behind Jerry Savile, behind the bigger story that Joe mentioned, are the ones closest to some look at a Council of 13 on a global scale, Satan being the primary one of the head of the chair. I could agree with that because there's got to be, you know, a tiered system, just like there is in the whole demonic realm. There are Cosmocrators, Archon, Exousia, Proneus Penumenicae, Planos. There are different kinds of demonic presences in a hierarchy, and then that spreads itself through to, let's call them the real Luciferians, the Mysterium. They are the ones that are engaging the Luciferic Satan presence, and they're here to do his will. They're here to bring a new order. They're here to be a part of the new order. And they believe in what they're doing.
And what you just articulated, we did a two-series show, The Power Behind the Veil, and we talked extensively about this as Satan has his agenda, you know, back from the beginning where building the Tower of Babel with Nimrod, that achievement was never completed. And throughout the ages, the elitist, both on the human elitist, have been driven by a spiritual, an evil spiritual agenda. And, you know, some of the things that have come upon this earth could not have been thought about through the mind of humans. There is obviously a demonic influence that pushed these agendas into the physical realm. You know, if you go to extra-biblical texts like the Book of Enoch, it explains in great detail what these spiritual entities and how they've corrupted mankind and continue to corrupt them towards bringing about an end of the world. And I believe in the times we're in now, all the things we're seeing in the Middle East, all the different spiritual and prophetic implications that we see, they're coming to a head. Things are changing and people really feel it. We get so many emails and phone calls and from people who are feeling alone in their own family, in their own church group, because their family members can't see the evil agendas that are pushing these, whatever you want to call them, that, you know, they think everything is fine and okay, and the way that they worship is fine and okay, that, you know, we're not in the end times, and life's going to go on. What would you say to the people out there who have been digging for the truth in scriptures and been close to the Lord, who have division in their own families, as they try to, you know, talk with them about this?
Well, I think here's a couple of things. And again, I mean, I believe if you hit the bee's nest, you know, the bees sometimes come at you. So anybody that is, I think anybody who's a soul winner, anybody who's doing God's work is going to be targeted. The Apostle Paul, you know, we've seen some of the worst, most incredible, crazy delays that we've ever had. I should have had 2 more books out 6 months ago. I should have. There's so many. And here's what I'm saying. I know that the enemy was involved with what occurred in really slowing things down and bringing harm. Notice this warlock guy of the West was doing curses against my daughter. Underground Satanists, you know what they think your vulnerability would be? Your family. They have no problem going after family. Satan, if he can go after your family, cause trouble inside, bring division there, that's a strategy of the dark side. That's no question a strategy of the dark side to bring, you know, anybody who's out there trying to serve the Lord, and then the enemy comes through the back door. He loves to use anybody in the flesh. He loves to use non-believers just to bring stuff in, and that's all it takes sometimes to bring harm. So that is part of the strategy. That's why I'm saying if we can be committed to becoming the strongest and spiritually wisest from the biblical, you know, revelation that we appropriate and live out, then we learn more, we listen to the Lord on a daily basis, and in a real sense, the more spiritually sensitive, Holy Spirit-wise we become, the more we see the attacks coming. I mean, Jesus warned the early disciples in that meeting, you know, Simon, Simon, Satan is at the sifting wheat. I believe the Lord gives us a heads up. And that we can, you know, we can be preempted, and we can be, you know, we can do warfare. I do warfare every day in the positive sense of, you know, I don't do it sitting back, feared, huddled in a corner. I mean, you know, I want to know what's going on. I want to strike out against the enemy. I want to come against anything, whether it's demons summon and sit against me or some other strategy. Because the truth is, even as believers, Joe, we are just, I don't have eyes in the back of my head. I am confident that God sees it all. Nothing gets past Jesus. In the room with the disciples, when Satan was coming in there to want to tear them all up, none of them felt or sensed or knew Satan entered in. Jesus did. So that's the good news. Staying close to Jesus, who knows every movement. The Holy Spirit knows every movement of the enemy. So when stuff starts to come, stuff starts to happen, Lord, what is this? You know, is it just people getting in the flesh? Is this the enemy coming in? And then we need to respond appropriately in that, you know, to help break the work of the enemy and to see. And no matter, again, I would say with me too, no matter how anybody, no matter what you know about spiritual warfare, and I want to read everything, I want to know everything, I want to be, you know, I want to be right there. Let me say this though. Clinging to the living Savior in confidence is the best spiritual warfare protection anybody can have.
Amen.
Clinging to Jesus Christ, the Savior, who has your back. This is 1 John chapter 5. Who has my back against the evil one? This Savior that loves me. This Savior that loves me pours his work through Psalm 91. My back is covered. I go to sleep at night. Demons don't. Satan doesn't go to sleep. They're all operative, and practitioners are summoning and sending demons, and pastors and people are waking up at 3 o'clock in the morning all over the place for the last 2 decades now, wondering, why am I waking up in the middle of the night? Why do I feel something came into my house? Why do I hear something on my roof? Why does my kid start crying at 3 o'clock in the morning? Well, the release of the demons after the rituals, if you're being targeted, that can be part of the, you know, the evidences. And so, yes, with the rise of satanic presence in the world, demon presence in the world, as the Spirit of God and the Scriptures say, we shouldn't be surprised. We should be powerfully prepared. Again, like David, the Goliath on a global scale is screaming. Some are not hearing. Others are backing away, further away from the sounds, up into the rocks where nothing happens. No defeat of the enemy, no power of God happens when we hide in the rocks. Instead, outrage of the enemy's presence is where we should stand. In the power, the presence, the backing, the confidence of his hand in our lives, the authority he gives us, the blood of the Lamb, that by that blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, they overcame the dragon himself, Revelation 12. So, I know I answer too long sometimes. In saying this, what we've seen and what we've even discussed right here is a scratch of what we're going to see in an exponential way coming in the next 6 months, the next year. If you think in terms of violence and all the stuff breaking out, behind the scenes is a growing mysterium, release of powers, more demons, more presence, more power, more advance, and that's the biblical pictures. A simple reading of 2 Thessalonians 2 gives you that Holy Spirit given, you know, it's like God ripped off Hell's Kitchen and said, hey, here's what they're doing. Here's the operative presence. Here's the sequential development of the satanic evolution in the world. Be prepared. Be wise. Look at the world as it's going crazy. Explain to the world the devil's on your neck and preach the indestructible, glorious, brilliant gospel of hope to every single creature we can find.
Amen, Russ. We're up against the top of the hour. We're going to take a quick commercial break when we come back. Got a few listener questions for you that have come in via email. We're listening to the Hagmann and Hagmann Report on this Wednesday, June 17th, 2015. Our guest tonight is Mr. Russ Dizdar. His website, shatterthedarkness.net. That's shatterthedarkness.net. Our number two of the Hagmann and Hagmann Report this Wednesday, June 17th, with our guest, Mr. Russ Dizdar. Again, his website is shatterthedarkness.net. His latest book is The Black Awakening. It's a must-read. It's eye-opening, and it talks about what is happening, what has happened, and what we expect to come. Russ, I have a question from a listener. She asks, my question, what if you were sexually abused before and with multiple people and you don't know what happened because you had lost time? And I know you deal with this, dealing with many SRA victims. What would your advice be to her?
Sure. First, sorry. You know, it's sad to know that it occurred. It's an outrage. It should have never happened. And number one, Jesus knows how to bring the healing and restoration to your life, and his presence and power will be beautiful in your life. But let me answer the question is this, in this way. Either way, whether it's in satanic ritual abuse, everyone in that field has been so traumatized they've been split purposely with subpersonalities, and so there's a lot of missing time issues. But you don't have to be an SRA to have missing time or to have blocked memory. Here's how it works: if a 4-year-old, a 5-year-old, an 8-year-old is sexually abused in a really bad way, very traumatic way, the way that a person responds is that they're pushed and pushed and pushed and pushed to the limits to where if they don't split, let me create an alternative part of them to carry all of that trauma and pain. It's kind of like the idea of the beach ball effect, pushed underwater. all, you know, an 8-year-old little girl, boy, whatever, you know, goes through this massive trauma. It happens again and again. And so they kind of dissociate and push it way, way back and way, way down. And so it's like taking a part of your memory that's very toxic and very emotionally packed and so forth, and thrusting it way, way, way back in your human experience, memory, consciousness. So that, like beach balls held underwater, as long as they're held down strong enough, long enough, I mean, you really don't, are not affected. But if you start thinking, you know, when you're 7 or 8 or 9 or 10, and all of a sudden you realize you have no memory of, you know, fifth being a fifth grader, you have no memory of many experiences in your life, then, you know, that memory is there. It's either buried because, you know, a 5 and a 6 and a 7, 8-year-old, they don't know how to process. How do you process this kind of violent experience? And so thrusting it way down in the back of consciousness and memory, and because it's so scary, and so it's been simply put down. For many who have been abused, it's been put down. For the SRA, they've been purposely pushed to the point of splitting, and say a person's name, and this is a random name, say a person's name is Janice. And so Janice goes through all this satanic ritual abuse, is split, and another part of her is created. Janice may not remember, I mean, the parts of her will remember what occurred, but it's encoded in those other parts of her. So she will have really lost memory completely, but the memory is embedded in the other personalities. Now, with a person that did not split, but they didn't bury their memory, that's just it. The memory is buried with the experience, and so you have blocked time periods. Now, I mentioned, you know, Psalm 139, search me, O Lord, and see if there's anything, you know, offensive in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. I use that in the sense of saying, may the Spirit of God come in and search, Lord, here am I. You can present yourself to the Lord, here am I. I want to know what occurred, where these blocks of memory are gone, where I don't remember. Lord, I know it's going to be scary, it's going to be hard, it's going to be, you know, tough to look at, but somewhere buried and locked down in there is the actual experience. Now, when the memories of the past begin to rise, all of a sudden the person can get very agitated, very fearful, because the fear and the terror and the confusion and the anger and the shame has been buried. As it begins to surface, you may begin to feel all of that until eventually, sometimes in the middle of the night, you have a dream or you have a flash of it, or during the day, a flash of it, and all of a sudden, it begins to come up. And it can be painful. You're allowed to cry. You're allowed to, you know, remember who it was that did it. And so there's a whole lot of issue. The number one thing I'm going to tell you is this. Never be ashamed to bring it all before Jesus. I say it this way. Bring the blood and the guts and the harm and the abuse. Bring it right before the throne of grace and say, Jesus, look. Look what they've done. Here's my pain. Here's my harm. He bore all of that on the cross. He's got the ability to pour the healing in you and to help release you and to lead you what you need to do to release the perpetrators, to release them into his hands for justice, and to lead you to really, you know, really find a complete freedom and a real sense of healing. He wants to get down there and bring the healing, but normally, when there is a complete block of memory in certain, you know, ages of a person's life, especially childhood, then at the very most, it's SRA, MPD. At the very least, which is, you know, bad enough, it's abuse. It's been buried so deep, it's not come back up yet.
Okay. Wow. Russ, in your book, you talk about satanic ritual abuse, as you were just referencing just now here in this answering that question. And what I was taking notes from your book in Satanic Ritual Abuse, I think you reference it as marriage to the beast. And you state that, number one, SRA, or Satanic Ritual Abuse, is most secretive, sophisticated, and powerful. Secondly, it's extremely evil, extremely demonic, It's got extreme demonic powers. Thirdly, the victims, they're born, raised, or chosen supernaturally energized. I'm looking here. I can't read my own writing here, but I think that you had given in numbers, like in the early 1990s, there were 2.4 million, and now up to 40 million and increasing. And you also note, for SRAs, a massive underground network built city to city, coven to coven. Every city has got covens. And then you also write about their agenda. They believe they're advancing the globalists, the New World Order, the agenda of Satan. And you reference, too, four generations of victims, the children, and just go on and on. I mean, this is huge. I mean, people really need to understand how widespread and how sophisticated, how evil, how secretive, how pervasive this is, and what the extent of the underground network, even in your, whoever, wherever you're listening from, you will have, based on your research, Russ, wherever anyone's listening from, you're going to have an underground satanic network. Is that a fair statement?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And we even did on the classes we've done live, Doug, we've done material on this to say, if you really want to find out in your city how to find out where, and, you know, we have some principles that we've done in a 14-hour teaching. It's free. All of it's free. Called Dark Rituals, Dark Powers. If you want to find it in your city, we can show you some of the principles by which, and here's the reason why, Ezekiel chapter 8, God willed it to be found out. And I believe that's true here, that if there's believers that want to find and want God to use them in the redemptive approach to the victim and in an aggressive praying against the demonic side, if you want, in your city, there's some principles that we've given that you'll be able to find it. You'll be able to engage it.
Mm. Can you tell us what some signs or what to look for? I don't know if people should be going out and, you know, searching for this kind of stuff, but if you happen across some things, because Joe and I were out doing something here not too long ago. And came across a situation that was obviously satanic, and I'll just leave it at that. But I mean, if you stumble upon something, what would you, Russ, use to identify or say, hey, wait a minute, this is satanic in nature? I mean, is it, you know?
Sure. And I always started this at this ground level, saying, anybody that's going to really engage all of this, number one, be dedicated, as any believer should be, to becoming the most powerful, knowledgeable, strong, growing, constantly growing believer. Anybody who's committed that way, having, you know, a development of faith, anybody that's weak that wants to hop into it's going to get blown away. I'm going to even say that I believe there's been officers that I know that just like, well, you know, I'm a believer and I got a gun and nothing's going to happen to me. I'm telling you, I've seen it in my own interaction over the years with law enforcement individuals that got involved. They get blown away spiritually, and the curses are real. I mean, the rituals are real, and if you have no protection and no defense, let alone offense, you can be deeply, horribly affected. And believers, like, look at again Peter. You know, he's going to stand up and die for Jesus, and yet, Jesus warns him Satan's going to do something, and he got kind of blown out of the waters for a little bit. We've all gotten blown out of the waters at times when we didn't know what to do, and that's what we need to get back up and grow again, get back up and learn again, say, Lord, and learn what we need to do. But I would say that in any city, and again, the one course that we I only got 14 hours up. Listen, I apologize. I know there's listeners that have been waiting for me, you know, to get. I'm literally. You guys are. I'm always running behind, but you know, we're really behind even in our getting the MP3s and teachings out. So in the live training classes on occult ritual crime and on spiritual warfare, There's hundreds of hours on our website, free, all of it free. So you can get more there. But Dark Rituals, Dark Powers goes over indicators, like the first MP3, seven indicators in your city. Part of those indicators that there's really, I believe, real dark rituals are being done is when there's a heightened level of over your city. It seems like there's a spiritual cloud, a spiritual darkness that is really just manifest over the whole of the city. There's more violence and bizarre violence. There's more gangland activity, human trafficking issues, a lot of drug issues, corruption in law enforcement. When you have all of this, you know, all of that dark presence opens the doors and helps welcome and perpetuate, you know, dark powers, dark presence. So those are some of the indicators. Now, here's a way outside of just looking at some of those indicators, beginning to pray and say, Lord, if there are satanic, ritually abused human beings in my city, and Jesus, you'll teach me how to minister to them, do deliverance, cast out demons, pray for healing to come into them and help them. Hear my Lord, send me. And I'm going to tell you this. I really believe that if you're going to step out and you're going to learn, you're going to read, and you're going to begin to pray that and say, Lord, help me find in my city any victims. I believe you will find them. I believe God will use you. I believe God is looking for people that he can really, really pour everything into, who's willing to go out there and be brave and fight for these individual victims, which means spiritually is the number one battle. Secondly, if you do go looking in this sense, if you contact any psych wards and counseling centers in your city and just simply call and say, hey, do you guys handle multiple personality disorder? And or have you ever heard of satanic ritual abuse? We have contacted almost every single major city in Pennsylvania and quite a few of the capital cities across the United States and hundreds now of psych wards and counseling centers. And 98% is always yes. So you're going to find out that the victims have been in your city for years. They've been going to counselors. They've been going to try to figure out what to do. The psychologists and psychiatrists in the cities for the last 30 years, you know, They know that these victims have been showing up. They're trying to treat them, but they're treating them with some drugs and in some cases, hypnotherapy and, you know, how to cope and so forth. They can't deal with the spiritual side of it. You're going to find them. I guarantee you, anyone listening in any city in the United States, you're going to find the real victims of this real, real Luciferian network. You're going to find victims that have come out. Now, if you find one victim in your city, I'm going to say you're going to find there's going to be four generations of them. You're going to find those between 55 and 65, those between 35, 45, those between, you know, I would say somewhere around 25, 26 to up as part of a second generation. And then you're going to go down to the teens into 25. There's the third generation. But in psych wards all across the United States, too, children's psych wards, you're going to find multiple personality in kids, and you can't have it without it being traumatic, sexual, harmful involvement. But many of them are realizing, hey, there's a satanic component. These kids are drawing satanic stuff. So you're going to find it. The issue is, what are you going to do when you find it? Because you're going to have to know how to cast out demons. You're going to have the armor of God to know your shielding. And, you know, if you go to help some of the victims, covens are going to begin to maybe, hey, what are you doing with our person? They see it as their property. So they're going to start doing warfare against you. If you go after them, here's the fact. They're going to come after you a little bit. This warlock out there in the West, wherever he's done this from, obviously in his own video that he put up, doing cursings and rituals, summoning of demons, Baron Simidi, you know, he's calling on a voodoo demon god, Loa, to, you know, could be sent after us. He did it in his own statement because we've been preaching the gospel and exposing dark side stuff and rituals and so forth. So he did it in response to what he must be listening to or what there's a group behind this out there. So if you do go after it, you will find it. The good news is you'll get to see the glory of the Lord, the power of God, the authority of Jesus, his destruction of the demonic realm when you use your authority against them. You're going to see Jesus bring healing to lives. You're going to have to expend time and money, and I'll be very blatant. You're going to have to risk your life a little bit. If you want to save kids out of human trafficking where you have people making millions, you're going to have drug lords and human trafficking pimp lords come after you and get angry at you for taking away their people. And if it's satanic ritual abuse and you're trying to draw these kids and you're trying to do deliverance and these adults, then the dark side's going to be mad. They're going to be mad. And so the choice is leave them in their bloody mess, you know, and back away as a believer, hide among the rocks where God won't do anything for all the ones that are hiding, or become enraged in this sense, outraged in this sense, like David when he really got sick of the Goliath on the field. Nobody else knew what to do. Well, the Spirit of God will help you. The Spirit of God will bring, you know, all kinds of help and guidance, and it has cost us over the years. It has cost us, you know, over the years. But the overwhelming seeing of the hand of God, the glory of God, the saving, the healing, the deliverance, and what Jesus wants us to do far outweighs the cost. And so I would just say to anyone, may the Spirit of God move you to be someone like in Isaiah 6 when he says, "Here am I, Lord, send me." That soul winning is the core of it all. If you're going out to win souls, go to the streets in your city. Go downtown and go to the streets and go to the areas. You're going to eventually find an SRA MPD. You're going to eventually, you know, hear about, you know, them talking, and it takes time. You're going to hear about the coven, where the ritual was, where this is over here, where that is over there, and it will be found out. You will engage.
Wow, very interesting and frightening that so many. You know, you said it best. If you find one victim in your city, there is bound to be many more. And I believe that is very true, as we know already that sexual abuse cases are widely underreported. Also, there seems to be a bias in the, you know, FBI and the governmental authorities that investigate these matters, that they believe that satanic rituals are not the true purpose behind, you know, some of the murders that take place. Their stats on that are very underplayed. But we see that there is an increase in these activities. And, you know, and I saw a story today out of Florida. They've banned prayer and Bibles from the school. Well, the city council has voted to allow satanic literature to be handed out in schools in Florida, promoting a diversity of religion. And it is no longer hidden in the shadows. It is being brought out to the light. Not only that, it is almost becoming acceptable in our society. In this country we live in, as we see the Supreme Court's decision on homosexual marriage coming up and a few other important decisions, how much longer can this country, how much longer will God let this country continue in promoting these perversions that were judged harshly in the Old Testament?
Man, you know, agreed. Barring the grace of God, agreed. I mean, the wrath of God is going to fall. There's no question. The only thing holding back, you know, 2 Peter chapter 3 in this, you know, in the reference to biblical prophecy, you know, God is not willing that anybody perish. You know, that he would rather see anyone, you know, everyone come to repentance. So, the only reason for the withholding of the hammer coming down, in a sense, the wrath of God coming down, is, you know, the operating grace and saving of souls. So there, you know, God still wants people saved. Now, I will say this: let's go back to 2 Thessalonians 2 again. When we read in the context of the parousia, the coming of the Lord, and that day will not occur until what occurs? Two things: apostasia and the apocalypse of Anthropos, the Anthropos Anonymous. I mean, he's called the man of lawlessness or sin, and So two things are going to occur before the parousia. This apostasia. Now, again, in my historical, biblical, Greek, Koine Greek look at that, that was primarily used in reference to massive events, a coup, a radical revolt, a rebellion. It's used in the book of Acts. It's also used in the Greek Septuagint of the Old Testament. When Moses came down from the mountain, the people rebelled and went back to the calf worship. So this term is not just about Christians slipping away. It's about an event that the parousia won't occur until, it's very emphatic in the original, until those two things occur. Now, in the context of that, then there's the mysterium. It's an operating, you know, presence between the demons and humans, operative in the world in a very synchronized, organized, detailed way, more than military systems. They're more powerful, more precise. Now, with that, look what it says. You know, Satan is the one behind the development of the Antichrist. Then there is Satan is at work with all kinds of counterfeit signs, wonders, miracles. Now, notice what else it says. The Spirit of God says, and in every sort of evil. The word in reference there is moral, decadent, radically moral evil. So, Joe, the rise of the – it's not just the homosexuals that are coming. It's Nambel that is coming. It is the it's also the necromancy. You know, listen, on the heels of the gay lesbian movement is Nambel, sex for children. On the heels of that, the necromantic ritual book put out, Sex with the Dead. It's unbelievably on the rise, and there's books written on that subject, and here's what the cry is in those books in the area of Sex with the Dead. The participants and the leaders and those who are writing in it, they think it's sacred. They think it's a holy thing. They think it's a loving thing. They think that they should have legal rights. They think they should have constitutional rights. They think they should have the rights to do that. So you're going to find that there's going to be lobbying for necrophilia. There's lobbying for bestiality. There's lobbying for pedophilia. Even the goal to change the global psychological, you know, disposition towards it, as they did with gay and lesbianism, you know, 40 years ago, to change the psychological disposition and to water it down and to alter it. So we're going to see wave. I mean, the three big things in the end of days: sexual decadence to the point of aggressive, addictive, uncontrollable sexual decadence is going to be predominant. If people are American, they're worried about the gays and lesbians coming out of the closet all over the place. And the untold story, Joe and Doug, is the thousands that have left that lifestyle, the thousands that have got saved, the thousands that say that that lifestyle is no good, doesn't work, it's wrong, they're glad to be free from it. But the sad thing is that because of their promotion of it, you've got now 8-year-olds saying they're gay. How do they know that? How do they even know anything about sex? How does an 8-year-old really understand that and know that? What is the perimeters for knowing that? But you've got now pedophilia issues that are being – they're lobbying for the rights and claiming that their civil rights are not being met. But I'm telling you right now, necrophilia, bestiality, necrophilia is going to be big, and the promotion of it is going to be big, that they have the right. So sexual decadence is inseparably linked to demonic presence, as in tantra sex, sex magic with Crowley, the seven churches in the book of Revelation. Jezebel, remember, her occult teaching led the believers into sexual decadence. Demonic manifestation and occult teaching always connects sexual decadence. Here's why. Here's what the Satanists themselves told me. Because they know that corrupted sexuality dirties the conscience, weakens the conscience, and opens the way to demonization.
Wow.
Judgment will fall. I pray that many get saved prior, but there's no question. Payday someday.
Okay. Powerful. Joe, go ahead. You were going to say something.
Yeah, you mentioned that this increase in the necrophilia. And it's not something that's comfortable to talk about. Can you explain what kind of powers do they believe that they can derive from this, or what purpose this serves?
Sure. Well, everybody kind of remembers the national story, two girls from Wisconsin lure a boy up from Texas offering sexual favors. They go to tie him up a little bit. They say they're going to tie him up in a sexual orgy and whatever else, and they're going to give him sex. But the goal was ultimately to stab him, to cut him, you know, bleed him and kill him and have sex with his body. They read, and again, I'm not asking anybody to read it. I have read it, but the Necromantic Ritual book written by a practitioner. I won't quote it, but I will tell you that it tells, and again, there's a number of other books written by funeral directors. Now listen to this, Joan Doug. Funeral directors. They know about sex with the dead more than anybody, because a lot of their, a lot of the folks within that structure have fallen to this practice. Sex with dead people is a, and I know this is going to be hard for some to understand, it's a big issue. There is a now a there are now sexual addiction issues with people in the business of the funeral, you know, parlors and so forth, and having sex with the dead. There's numerous books written on the subject now. There's a number of those coming out of the world of you know, funerals and those businesses telling the stories. But there's a growing element among just practitioners. Now, I'm going to tell you something. This is a little bit out of the book, the Necromantic Ritual book. This goes all the way back to the Old Testament again. They had sex with the dead back then. It was forbidden by God, of course, because of a number of things. In the book, the Necromantic, you know, Ritual book that's put out, the person, the practitioner, goes into big descriptions of how arousal occurs and how the sacredness of it all occurs, how the spiritual feeling of it all occurs when they begin to engage the dead corpse in sexual, full-blown sexual encounter. I'm not going to go any further than that other than to say this. In all of SRA, Satanic Ritual Abuse, there are sex rituals for the sake of transferring demons from the practitioner into the victim. In Crowley's teaching of sex magic, in Tantra, in pantheism and Hinduism and so forth, in many of the new age-oriented sexual energy things they're teaching to transfer energies, well, the energies are connected to the entity that is manifesting it, the demon. There is real dark powers in the context of because, again, the demons, this comes from the practitioners primarily, the demons cling to perverted sexual, that's why even in the killing, there's always a sexual component to raise the sexual energies so the demons can come and house themselves in that. They are predatory on that. Demons know how to rape. There is such a thing as incubus, succubus. Sleep paralysis involves demons coming in to visit people. What nobody's telling is what everybody's really experiencing is the demon doesn't want to just come in and put them, paralyze them. He's paralyzing them, number one, to eventually get them engaged sexually so they can have the demon can have a deeper, you know, clutch into the person. And number two, to draw them out of their body and then really have a level of possession. So that's a worldwide phenomenon right now. So the old stories of incubus succubus are by the tens of thousands worldwide. Demons look for perverted oriented sexual engagement. They lead humans into the addiction of it. Sex with the dead is a major part of occult oriented. I can if you want me to, I can tell you of one ritual that was done, but it's ugly and it's horrific. Some people may not want to hear about it, and maybe you don't want me to tell it over the air, but it's real stuff being done.
No, I think people need to hear this, Russ. Don't hold back. People, you know, if this this is going to upset anyone, just back away, turn down your volume. But, Russ, I think people need to hear what's really taking place. The churches aren't talking about this. Pastors aren't talking about it. It's not on alternative media, you know, the demonic component. So no, please let's get into this here.
Well, and I'm going to say that there's going to be, globally, you're going to, more stories of sex with spirits, demons, are going to come out. Some are going to be really into it. I've had people come in, professor from university come in, others come in, officer comes in, women come in. They tell this, they're ashamed, they're afraid to tell, but they tell the whole story. So there's a massive growing engagement. The demons are seeking this for a reason. Now, when it comes to the satanic rituals, the again, we talk about the real Luciferian, that which is behind the satanic ritual abuse. Everyone in that field, and by the way, let me just say to them listening, this may be triggering, so you may, you know, just caution for all of those SRAs that may be listening. This kind of ritual has been described a number of times. Here's one. And this is just one of the many, many, many stories over the years that's been told. Dead body of a male is brought in. That was, you know, an abduction occurred, a ritual was done, the person was killed. Their private parts were cut off, cut out. They were sewn onto a female living person. And a sex ritual occurred during, you know, a whole... I don't feel permitted to go any further than say that much of the whole thing. I'm just going to tell you that's how perverted, that's how demented. This is what the demons are dirty, Doug and Joe. They're dirty. They're perverted. That's their nature. And if they could pervert humanity, and addict humanity, and give supernatural feelings in that perverted addiction, they will. Serial rapist murderers that are out, Ted Bundy, John Wayne Gacy, Jeffrey Dahmer, all of them were multiples. Jeffrey Dahmer, that's the only one I know for sure, was deeply satanically versed, which didn't come out anywhere in law enforcement. But that kind of ritual, and any SRA that's listening, I don't want to trigger anybody, but I know they can write you, they can tell you. I don't care if they come from Canada, Germany, Australia, United States, your city. They can tell you. What I just said is something they've experienced all of their life from childhood up. They've seen every kind of perverted sexual animals and humans, demons and humans. They can express the every ounce of what it was like, and the biblical picture again with more demonic presence, coming. That means that more engagement, and I think there's a connection between this and the their goal of the recreation and the bringing back of Nephilim, and there is no Nephilim without demon, fallen angels, and human interaction. And so I think it has a connection to that, too.
That's an interesting point you raised there. The Nephilim, the fallen ones and the hybrid. Of course, the Nephilim having sex with human women and the offspring being the Rephaim, if we use Steve Quayle's lexicon of... Regarding this issue, you've got your Nephilim, the fallen angels, mating with human women. The offspring is the Rephaim, and of course, demons are disembodied spirits of the Rephaim. Now, this again is the lexicon being used and standardized by Steve Quayle. Having said all of that, we're seeing this resurgence today. That's where this applies. You know, people will often write us and say, why are you focusing with everything going on? Why are you focusing this particular show or that show on, you know, the Nephilim or, you know, this type of thing? But it's relevant, isn't it? I mean, this, what we're seeing here is is really this resurrection of these old ancient rites and rituals from antiquity.
Sure. Well, let me say, first of all, thank God for Steve being the pioneer and the one cutting-edge person that years before anybody else was bringing it all out. He's taken a lot of hits for it, and yet he's correct. I mean, the issue of the rise of the Nephilim, there's nothing in all of biblical literature that says it won't happen again. It tells us in Genesis 6, the Nephilim were on the earth in that day, and then again later, and we look at it in Numbers, and as you've mentioned, you can see them among the Immims, and you can see them among the Zemzumis, and so forth. Many of the tribes, I believe Goliath was either Nephilim direct or Nephilim second generation. Globally, they were here hundreds of years. They were a menace. They were never considered human, but here's the interesting side. And we're doing a conference coming up in September, along with the chief of the Tano tribe in America. This is the tribe that found that engaged Columbus and found Columbus, the Tano tribe. So the chief is coming as a powerful born-again believer in Christ to talk about the Native Indian American experience of battling the giants, fighting the giants. He's got a book out called The Old Ones. He's coming to this conference to bring a whole other picture into, hey, this is not only real, they're the ones that are behind the mounds. The Nephilim were in America behind the mounds. It was a global phenomenon. That's why the flood had to be global, because God needed to wipe the menace of this out. Now, here's the other side of the story. Why do we need to talk about it? Why do we need to have it out there? Well, because, number one, it's a biblical revelation. It's part of Scripture. It's a huge part because it's part of the reason for the flood. It's part of the primary reasons for the battles of Israel in occult-oriented, baby-sacrificing, blood ritual nations around them. The Moabites, the Philistines, they understood this. That's what they were a part of. But here's the other side of the story. I believe that we can track back just simply 60, 70 years, and you have Aleister Crowley seeking hybrid demon-human offspring. You have Jack Parsons in Mojave Desert, the rocket scientist seeking the Babylon working. He's seeking a demon-human hybrid. You have among all New Agers worldwide, they believe that there's something going on to the creation of, having sex with fallen angels to create a star child and to create a new hybrid humanity. You have the whole alien deception in the air and the abduction scenarios, the creation of hybrid beings. You have modern day satanic ritual abuse, and I'm still saying 40 million worldwide. But that all goes back to Nazi Germany and Lebensborn and a reality in history. The reality was they wanted a master race to be the troops that would enforce a worldwide 1,000-year reign. That's real history, but not enough have gone into the details of Lebensborn, the secret birthing centers, where they spiritually selected the people to do what? To back breed to the ancient Aryan. The ancient Aryan were Nephilim. They were godmen. They were hybrids. So the entire Himmler-Hitler agenda to back breed Germans who can prove some level of German descent, back breed them so that they can create the master race. That wasn't a master race of humans. It was going to be a master race of godmen. And they, something spiritually, well, Satan, demons, were guiding them to seek the recreation of Nephilim. Doug and Joe, worldwide satanic ritual abuse shouldn't be called satanic, even though it involves satanic ritual abuse. The agenda of 40 million is to bring back charged Nephilim blood, Nephilim DNA, to try, whether they've done it or not, to try to recreate Nephilim. Now, go forward. I believe the Antichrist is a hybrid. I believe the false prophet is a hybrid. They're called Therion in the book of Revelation. God specifically named them that throughout the book, but specifically in Revelation 13. He's called Therion, or Therion. That word, whether you look in biblical Koine Greek, take it to the Greek Septuagint, it means a violent, bestial, non-human but human it's a description of their very nature. And I believe the Antichrist is a hybrid. Direct Satan to chosen fallen female to counterfeit the actual incarnation. The Antichrist is not somebody that becomes demon-possessed. He is selectively designed to be born in a counterfeit to the incarnation of Jesus Christ himself. That's my opinion. That's my belief based on the biblical revelation that everything Satan does, everything he does to the detail, is in counterfeit to what God has done, is doing, or will do. So the Antichrist, I believe, is a hybrid, if you want to say Nephilim, probably the ultimate Nephilim. He is Homo Satanus. He is literally Satan in human skin.
Mm.
This is why we need to talk about it. This is why. That individual helped bring 2 to 4 billion deaths and bring the globe to almost an extinction-level event. We're talking extinction-level events here in the end of days. Jesus said they're unprecedented, so you and I have got to look at biblical prophecy to see future history, Dr. Joe. We've got to see that this is beyond anything that's ever happened in human history, and it involves, I believe, a return of the hybrid, and that Antichrist himself is bloodlined, and that the Antichrist is a fallen cherub to direct chosen satanic woman, demonized woman, to create their goal, a direct counterfeit to the incarnation. So who are we going to sit back as Christians and let the transhumanists talk about their connection to the gods with the Russian cosmists leading them to create immortality? Are we going to sit back to the occultists and the New Agers and the Gnostics and all the rest of everybody else perverting the version of Nephilim being radically evil, and they're trying to recreate it? Do we sit back and let the rest of them tell the world what this is and bring a convoluted view? Christians have to stand and tell the biblical view, past, present, and what's to come, in a bold way in the context then of preaching the gospel. And thank God for Steve. Thank God that he stood out there, he took the punches all along the way to bring it out, and now many others have written more books on Nephilim ever in history in this last 10 years. And there's a reason. The dark side's wanting it.
The dark side is wanting it. Okay, the dark side is going. I mean, that's the agenda of the dark side, not the exposure thereof, and if you can clarify what you just said there, I you kind of lost me there.
I believe that this demonic realm guided the Nazi development. I believe the political philosophical view of the Nazi was literally charged political ideology. It was demonic teaching downloaded that became political ideology, what ran the whole thing. And part of that involved, hey, we got to create a master race. We got to have rituals in Vadelsburg Castle. We got to Villigoth the sorcerer's got to do rituals. We got to go and find any Germans that can prove they had Aryan descent. And because in their view, the Aryan was the Helena Blavatsky's version of the Godmen, the ancient Nephilim. So the entire war, World War II, involved a vision. Part of the reason for the war was to create, the vision was for them to develop tens of thousands upon thousands of hybrid Godmen, Ubermon, soldiers that could be the ones to help bring about and enforce a 1,000-year Reich, counterfeit to the coming millennium, of course. That's what it was all about. So the history is charged with the redevelopment of Nephilim. Lavensborn was all about the recreation of Nephilim. Jack Parsons, all the rest of them. So what I'm saying is I believe the dark side has an agenda to create altered humans. That's the transhumanist view, and I was at the actual 2045 meeting in New York with Ray Kurzweil and Dmitry Idzkov and the Russian cosmist as they combined the highest levels of science with ancient great white brotherhood gods declaring the goal for the transhumanists are to recreate the God-men, half human, half gods. That was declared on the stage in New York at Lincoln Plaza. I sat in the 10 feet away from these guys as the top geneticists, top scientists, top transhumanists described their view of creating the immortals. When the cosmists and gurus came on stage and they showed slides of the ancient gods, which are the demons, Ephesians 6, that they're declaring that they're going to lead the scientists to bring the hybrids again. They want what I'm saying in that statement is I believe that's the dark side's agenda, to recreate altered and hybrid beings in the development of the satanic order that's to come.
Okay.
I'll give one example biblically, prophetically. Revelation 6, white horse, red horse, black horse, pale green horse. Well, in the pale green horse, you have one-fourth of mankind dead. You have billions probably dead. And God describes what is the cause behind all these people dying. Number one, the biblical Greek word for war, actual war, then pestilence, then famine. And then it says, and the beasts of the earth in the English. It's the Greek, therion. So helping to kill hundreds of millions in a short period of time are therion. In biblical context, scripture interprets scripture. In the biblical context, I believe we're talking about hybrids or very altered beings that are going to be used in the slaughter of hundreds of millions. Therion. It's not going to be hamsters and giraffes gone wild killing hundreds of millions. It's going to be beasts, therion, most likely hybrid beings that are going to be involved in that. It's my opinion. Mm.
All right. Wow. When you mentioned German, the Nazis, the agenda there, the pink swastika of the book. Earlier, you were talking about the homosexual agenda, the perversion that of the homosexuals. What's the connection, if any, between the perverse homosexual aspect of the Nazis, well known now, well documented, but not discussed very much. And,
right.
Where does that fit in to what you just described?
Well, I believe it's documented too, that Hitler was like, he was pumping homosexuality for all the other nations. He knew it corrupted the nation. I believe that the inner circle was sexually corrupt because, again, when you embrace demonic presence, part of the addiction, part of the hold, part of all ritualism that comes into it, and I don't care if that's voodoo, Santeria, you can talk about all of them, specifically SRA, all worldwide, sexual ritual is part of it because the perversion sexually helps bring the demonic and helps transfer the demonic, helps people to receive the demonic. It's just part of the whole. And so I believe that there was, behind the scenes, major sexual perversion and use within the Nazi system. And I believe that, again, sexual corruption is part of the satanic plan. Just as we read in 2 Thessalonians 2 about pseudo, the Greek word pseudo there, counterfeit, sign, wonder, or miracle. Those three things that Jesus did are going to be counterfeited on a global scale by Satan's operating presence. But that it doesn't stop there. It says, and every sort or every kind of evil or wickedness. That word has the moral component of sexual addiction. So Satan's operating strategic design is to bring sexual decadent corruption that opens the door to satanic influence, if not eventually attachment or possession. We have, not in all cases, but in a few, I can tell you one case when a police officer stood right next to me. We commanded a demon that manifested in a highly, highly sexually permissive, demonized 19-year-old man. The demon came forward, the hideous voice. It was a sexually oriented, dirty, filthy, unclean spirit that led him into that. And where did it come from? he went to an underground rave where an older man, well, basically forced him into a sexual encounter and transferred demons from the man into the other boy. And that demon, when we dealt with him, of course, by the authority of Jesus, had to come up, and we had to, you know, command it out off of him, because this guy was just, he was after everybody. So there is within sexual decadence, homosexuality, sexual hedonism, there is a demonic drive. Because it brings addiction, it brings open doors for the enemy, and they can come in and they can transfer and they can be a part. I've read the Pink Swastika some time ago, and I believe that was dirtying the human construct.
Gotcha.
And opening the door for demonic presence, sexual perversion will do it.
Indeed.
With that point, Russ, let's take a quick break as we're at the top of the hour.
Already.
And we're going to come back with our third and final hour. I got some questions. We have some listener questions, and there's some pretty relevant and interesting ones. So take a quick break. We'll
Before the break, I just want to say, Russ, thank you so much. Look, we know how busy you are. We know what you've been through over the last couple of weeks. I just want to say thank you so very much for being for making us your first interview in the midst of all the chaos, commotion, and problems that you're encountering and have encountered. Thank you just so much, and thank your wife as well and your family for allowing you to spend this much time with us. It's really appreciated.
Absolutely. Blessings. Thank you.
All right.
Sure.
All right, folks, you're listening to the Hagmann and Hagmann Report on this Wednesday, June 17th, 2015. Our guest is Mr. Russ Dizdar. Grab his book, The Black Awakening. It is a fantastic read, so different from many of the other books pertaining to prophecy, as Russ has in his experience dealing and delivering SRA victims, has come across a plot of the darkest and
you just have to read the book.
You have to read the book. His website, shatterthedarkness.net. Then went to our third and final hour on this Wednesday edition with our guest, Mr. Russ Dizdar. His website, shatterthedarkness.net. This show has just been flying by. Russ, got a few questions from the audience, and the first one is coming from me and from the audience, as many of the guests we've had on in the recent past. This question has come up, and you dealing with the SRA and the spiritual wickedness, CERN. We see CERN has been ramping up their hydrogen collider. They're talking about, you know, bringing in interdimensional beings or trying to bring in interdimensional beings. They have their statue of Shiva in front of CERN.
That's a good idea, by the way. Right.
What is your take on CERN? What do you really think they're trying to accomplish, and do you believe they can accomplish their mission?
Well, good. We did a couple of mentions on this. I think two or three broadcasts on it. I think Steve and I did think one thing on the abyss I brought up. The interesting thing is the reason Revelation chapter 9 is there is because, you know, God selected to give us insight that in the future the king of the abyss is going to come and he's going to get the keys. In biblical sense, the rights. He'll have the act. He'll find out the rights, the way in which this gateway is going to be open. Now, when the gateway is open, look at the result, how huge it is. I believe it's dimensional. I believe a dimensional gateway is going to open, and that on a visible scale, if you read the biblical Greek, they come down upon the earth and begin to, you know. And of course, God had to limit their, you know, unless they would annihilate everything. It would be, you know, that opening of the abyss would be an extinction level event, barring that God has limited what they could do. Now, I say that to say this: what will open that? I believe when I went back on that whole series I did on CERN, you know, with the Atlas and, you know, the God particle and their whole belief that they can go beyond the point of the initial creation, grab what's behind that. The idea is grab the finger of God, pull it into the Atlas part of the CERN thing, and kind of like cut off the tip, you know, get a piece of God in a sense, and dissect it. I believe it's far beyond that. I believe, just as I believe demonic dark powers guided the Germans in weaponry, let alone you know, the whole design, I believe there's dark powers guiding this development of technology. This was prophesied demonically in a book called The Externalization of the Hierarchy by Alice Bailey in 1937. The demon that entered into her in the actual demonic writings of that particular book described an evolutionary development of them guiding scientists to the point that they, with the demons and the spiritual powers and the hierarchy, would open a gateway and bring down the veil and open the door between that side and this. The demons would teach the scientists how to do it. Now, is this what's happening? Is there a dark presence along with this demon god that they are honoring at CERN? Is this what is occurring? Is this going to be used to open the dimensional gateway? Now, I could say that's a very clear possibility for a number of reasons. Scientists from CERN, and I quoted this when I did the series, it's out there. One of the scientists says this, that he fears that what they're going to do is open, they believe, they know they're going to open up temporary black holes, but he fears they may open up one so big that they can't shut it, and it would be cataclysmic to the human race. So the other side is, does the dark side tell the scientists what they're doing in order to, you know, bring about, you know, their agenda of the world? No. Does, and this is very important for Armageddon also. Because Armageddon itself, Revelation 19:19, when the beast goes on the field, he has the largest, most sophisticated, most powerful, but yet demonized soldier army base in human history there to raise their weapons towards the sky. They're gonna try to eliminate Christ's visible descent. That's what Armageddon's all about. How does he get the weapons? How do they get the weapons for that day in the descent of the visible descent of Christ, to raise their weapons to try to stop his descent? That's what Armageddon's all about. That's been missed for hundreds of years by the theologians and even prophecy teachers. Armageddon is all about not wars against, you know, nations, the globalist, most powerful, demonized nation. Now, if you look at Revelation 19:19, back up to Revelation 16, and out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the Antichrist, out of the mouth of the false prophet come demons. They are sent out to the kings of the earth to look at the design, look at the target, look at the reason, to gather them together for the great day of God Almighty for Armageddon. Now, it's a spiritual global release to gather them together for this development. I don't believe when all hell begins to break loose on a global scale, all of these events have particular, it's all going to be by demonic power. Even in the book of Daniel, the prophecy in Daniel, you know, God shows the beginnings of the little horn and his beast system coming, that it's not by human hands, meaning that it's a supernatural, and it won't come down by human hands. God's going to bring it down. And that's when Christ returns. So the declaration 2,600 years ago, this entire system is going to come about by supernatural power, and will only come by, you know, come down by a higher supernatural power, God, in Christ specifically. So CERN to me is another possible. I mentioned in my maybe you saw it in one of the presentations when I did R1919, a book out by DOD and NASA, their weapons development specialists. The title of the book, Planetary Defense Weapon Systems. They believe they need to develop planetary weapons that can shoot up into the sky in case some dimensional door opens and something comes down towards the earth. I believe that's nothing more than Satan prepping scientists to develop the weapons that he needs to try to stop Christ. I believe CERN, and again, it's my opinion, I believe CERN is a spiritually guided high technology that its ultimate use is not even yet in the minds of the scientists that are there. Satan has his predatory, you know, future use. could that be what opens a gateway, a dimensional gateway to that very abyss that allows what's there to descend on the earth? I believe that's a high possibility.
Man, that's enough to keep you awake at night. I mean, we're all are concerned about what's going on in the, what's going on. In your book, The Black Awakening, you do discuss a lot about Revelation 19:19. And, of course, the one statement when you were talking here, I looked it up in your book. You write, read Revelation 19:19 again, and you will see that the demons sent had an assignment. They had their designated target. And you go on to discuss this. The targets of Illuminati, Luciferian, or ancient brotherhood are. And, of course, you go through the list of pastors and Christian leaders, churches, and especially the ones that matter to them, the Bible-rich churches, Christian ministries that are making a great effect, political leaders who need to be recruited or influenced. I'm starting to put this together, as you were laying this out, as we see here, the final battle is shaping up. It's not just going to be weapons of war of man, but of, as you put it, weapons of war of other dimensions. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Jeez.
Yes.
Okay.
See, I really believe that the book written by Alice Bailey, who wrote 21 volumes, when a entity fused, they call it fused into her, she sat down 6 to 8 hours a day. That's part of the prophecy of 1 Timothy 4:1, when the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times, many are going to be, believing the faith. Why? Because now the Greek word planos, seducing, imposter-oriented spirits. They're going to come to deceive the many, but they're also going to come to guide some people into writings, to write charged literature. I believe every one of her writing, her books, and I got quite a few of them, I believe they are the most, they have been some of the most spiritually charged literature I've ever seen. Her book, Hierarchy of the Externalization of the Hierarchy, is all about, in my view of it, reading it, looking at it, examining it, I really believe it's a demonic, real demonic teaching on how they will proceed. And their goal is to, according to that book anyway, their goal is to operate, breathe down the necks of, lead, guide, direct scientists to develop the technologies that will open the doors to that dimension, which, again, CERN very pointedly can do. If they're going to create, if they're going to create dimensional rifts, that's what opening the gate in Revelation 9 is all about. It's opening up to another, wherever it's actually located, the abusos is dimensionally a lockdown. And when that is open, it has a massive global tearing up. It's literally going to bring a massive tearing up to the atmosphere on a global scale, and let alone the entities that are going to come rushing out of it. It's like a blast furnace. So I do believe it's an opening dimensionally of the abyss, and the CERN thing can do that. But I also believe that technologies to, like, particle beams, chemical lasers, and something even beyond that, are going to be guided by entities breathing down the necks of weapons development specialists in the DOD or other places around the world, just as they were guiding to create Psy Warriors in Russia and the United States. I believe they've got to have that weaponry. So this is what's great about biblical prophecy. It shows us in the future. And that's what I did with Revelation 19:19. I said, listen, that one verse shows us that that Antichrist makes it on the field, that he actually has a globalist army, and that army isn't to fight each other. They're going to raise their weapons into the sky. What kind of weapons will those be? That's the apex. That's the culmination, because that's the day in which Jesus is going to bring utter, absolute annihilation of the globalist army. most powerful pinnacle of their existence. He's gonna destroy it within 5, 10, 15, 20 minutes and throw the Antichrist and the false prophet. So all the globalists and all the real Luciferians that believe that the Lucifer guys is, you know, once again, they're going to be, just like in all of history with him, going to be blown out of the waters. All those who have aligned with him are going to be blown out of the waters, are going to lose their souls. It's already prophesied. Those who think they're going to be the troops of Antichrist are going to be the fodder. Revelation 19, verse 20 and 21 is all about them. They're going to be utter destruction, but in order to be there, Doug and Joe, the development of the most sophisticated weapons in human history, and I believe that the only way that can come about is through demonic guidance, the charging of minds. I believe we can find a history. There's a book called Psy Spies. I'm forgetting the name. Jim Mars wrote the book, and he quotes how the Germans would always talk about how the Nazis would talk about how the, and their, his quote was, non-human intelligences would guide them in the development of weapons. Well, that's true in Wadelsburg Castle, where they used to sit, meditate with the 13 skulls, charred skulls, to get the guidance from non-human entities, demons. They didn't call them demons. They called them non-human entities, to give them advantage in war. The weaponization of demonic presence goes back to the king of Moab in the Old Testament, where he weaponized powers to fall on his army to defeat Israel. And when he did what he did, a human sacrifice, the powers fell on the army, the Moabites, and they defeated Israel. Supernatural powers will be involved in the development of the technologies and the development of the super soldiers for Revelation 19:19. And I think that's still connected to, and part of the reasons for the abyss. We don't even have time to go into that, but God has given this picture already. We already have this future global, unbelievable event. And notice how this too, Doug and Joe, that you hear it on Coast to Coast, you hear it everywhere else. There's literally thousands worldwide. Dr. Stephen Greer, the rest of them, they're doing everything they can, using every occult means to contact the Orions, the Pleiadians, and so forth, these, and get them to materialize, to become the host, to get disclosure. They all want disclosure. They all want them to come. They all want them to arrive. You know what? They're going to arrive. In Revelation 9, they're going to come down upon the earth, but it's not what they think. They're being used to create the doorway, and that doorway will be opened. And when those things come down upon the earth, look at the results. Destruction to humanity. The only ones preserved, those who have the mark of God.
Hmm. Yeah. And
yeah, that's not what they think. You know, I mean, yeah.
And wow. I got a question here, Russ, from a listener, and this has to do with the Black Awakening. This is from Charlotte. She says she met you several years ago for help. And goes on to say, every time I see pictures of ISIS, how they dress and what they are doing and threatening, I wonder if they are part of the Black Awakening and could they be somehow related to the underground Nazi activity. I've especially wondered this since we've begun to hear ISIS has infiltrated the U.S. and made threats against Americans. As a very young preschool child, I had vivid dreams about a Nazi-type takeover here in the United States and think those were probably related to my early SRA programming.
Sure. Well, first of all, blessings and may God's kindness and grace to Charlotte remember you and remember you well, and pray for God's blessings and kindness to you and healing all the way. Now, yeah, I agree with her. I mean, Charlotte, as you say right there, millions of people, of victims like Charlotte, can all tell you the same thing. Whether anybody wants to believe it or not, all of the SRAs, when they really get down to the cult loyal parts, they all know they've been created to be the troops of the coming Superman, the Antichrist, as we see him. So, and it all has its roots in the Nazism and the Lebensborn and so forth. So, so on that field, I think she's absolutely right, along with all the rest of them, that that's what they've been created for. That's the dark side's agenda for them. Now, the other side of this is ISIS. Let's remember who Allah is. And every political person and every individual and every person that's really smart should understand this. Allah has never been, is not and never will be God, capital G. Allah is an entity, most likely the Prince of Persia, that was back in Daniel's day over that exact land, over that exact area, the exact territorial area that you have the old Persian kingdom is where you find now Iraq and Iran and, you know, all the surrounding areas where Allah is embraced. Allah is real. He is a high, high level demonic entity, more than territorial. I believe he is a national, regional, but a high level entity. Anybody reading the Quran will know that Allah does not want to be known on a personal basis. He declares he's not a personal being for people to know. He just wants submission. So, do I believe that, and here's what I want, and this is what the president is lying about. Here's what many of the political leaders have no clue. The entire, whether it's Islam, whether it's Al-Qaeda, whether it's the rest of them, anyone connected to Allah submitting to the demonic doctrine of the Quran will be spiritually embraced. And they will be used in their submission and willingness, because the Shahada is no different than a satanic ritual summoning Satan. The Shahada is a summoning of Allah. And it brings about that presence. Every mosque has a spiritual presence connected to it. And notice the how anti-Christ it is, anti-real God it is. And it's not just, see, their view, spiritually speaking, they got to shut down the West, because here's with some of the greatest release of missions and freedom in Christianity and so forth has gone on for years and decades and decades. So that's the real spiritual component. They want Israel annihilated. They want the UK and the United States annihilated, not just on a political basis, on a spiritual one. So I believe that ISIS is very similar to the coming radical super soldiers that will, I believe, be unleashed here in the near future. Do I believe ISIS is directly them? No. Do I believe they are part of the whole, you know, scheme of things for the end of days? Absolutely. And are they demonically charged and guided and led for what they do? Yes. Are there bloody sacrificial killings and head cuttings? Is that all sacrificial and ritualistic in the sense that it draws demons and brings a frenzy and a reveling to the demons? Yes. It is demonic from head to toe. Political leaders and military leaders that don't get this are doomed in their fight against a spiritually charged a military system, no differently than Moabites in the Old Testament, where demons came down, charged and enabled a lesser number, I believe, of Moabite soldiers to become so fierce and so supernaturally charged they would defeat all of Israel in that moment anyway. So dark powers are part of the are weaponized and militarized, and ISIS is an example of that.
Oh, wow, that does answer a lot. I mean, it addresses a wide range of aspects of ISIS. And the acronym, too, ISIS, does that bother you when you consider the goddess ISIS and Semiramis and so on? I mean, have you taken notice of that, Russ?
Yeah, it does, because, again, you have this honoring any entity. We got to remember how real these entities are, how the demonic realm is. When you think in terms of maggots, it's like this warlock guy from out west. He shows an arrogance. They all do. The priestesses, the priests, the maggots, they show a sense of we're superior. That's the Lebensborn principle, superior beings. So, and that only shows a little manifestation of what the demons are all about. They are elitists. They are, you know, they are to be worshipped. They are to be bowed down to. They're superior to humans. So you have, well, even when it comes to Bohemian Grove, just to state, it's not Moloch. The owl is Semiramis. The owl is the really ancient. It's really ancient, really powerful, and that's what they're paying homage to there, and that's what's being paid homage to there under the, you know, owl is a finite territorial being, but you've got to have hundreds of other demons under the structure, of Allah in order to cover that much ground and that many people, because Satan and demons are not omnipresent. They have to be connected. They have to be have a collective to operate and fight. And I simply believe that everything about them honors the ancient ones. Notice again, Babylon itself was there in Iraq. Notice this is where the ancient where did the Nephilim roam in the beginning? This is the land of the Nephilim. This is the land close to where the fallen the Nephilim came down. This is where they all began to spread out. And so you have the entire development, you have Nimrod, you have the Tower of Babel, you have all of you have Moloch and Shemosh and Nebo. All of the ancient gods and everything were all over that territory. Did they die? Demons don't die. Demon gods don't die. They just resummon people and reestablish. That's all that's happened over there. They've reestablished. And there's a massive, massive wide-open door for them to operate in bringing the destruction and instilling the violence and terror. And look how and people are, you know how Doug and Joe how many kids and other people around the world are being sucked into they're being through Facebook and other places being drawn in and recruited. Let me tell you this: the recruiting I believe is supernatural. I believe there's a supernatural power behind the rhetoric to draw people in. That's I see them no differently blinded than I see cult members and other groups. They're spiritually guided and directed, and the outcome is the same. You know, violence, destruction of lives, a servitude to the demons that have drawn them. And they don't even know. They don't even know in the end their lives are going to be utterly decimated, and they're going to lose their souls outside of Jesus.
Very good. Well, I mean, I like your assessment, and I think that's right on the money.
Another listener question, Russ. It says, Doug and Joe, can you please ask Russ this question? I'm wondering if he thinks that people in the abortion industry are involved in the blood rituals. I mean, could they be either giving or spelling the aborted babies to Satanists for use in the blood rituals? A terrifying thought.
Very terrifying thought. My wife worked and still has is a part of the pregnancy saving babies and acro pregnancy services for, you know, almost 15 years. So, you know, keeping women from doing the abortion issue. I believe that abortion, if you think again what it does, you know, whether it's partial birth is a murder, it's an outright slaughter to shoot a kid in the back of the head. In the old ways of reaching up into the womb and just crushing the head and destroying the child. Jesus called the baby in the womb brephos, meaning a child, a living human being. From the moment of conception, deductionism is a biblical concept of the spirit of God, the spirit, the moment the sperm enters the egg and the human spirit is created, and that's the power behind the human being. So the answer to the question, though, is this, yes. Do you remember some of the stories lately of and some of the dock workers that have found cases of fetuses in jars and in bins? Because there's ritual connected to that, and there's belief that in the consumption of and the use in rituals, of course, you're going to have demonic presence and power come into that. There are rituals right now where, and any SRA can tell you this, where the breeder is impregnated, the baby's taken early on and used in a ritual, and because among the real Luciferian, a baby tortured, sliced up, and killed, and eaten draws some of the greatest of powers. And a fetus will do the same. There's a real, the physics of the dark side are so perverted. And so I believe that abortion was, I go back, my opinion is, I think it was taught by fallen angels. And that goes outside of Scripture to Enoch, but I believe that they guided that in the very beginning anyway. So it is a murder slaughter. It's as bloody and ritualistic as is a real, you know, satanic, luciferic ritual, or is a ISIS, you know, cutting off a human head of an adult and killing them the way they do. Both would appease the dark side. Now, in the structure, you do know, like, fetuses, can be sold off to make makeup and all this other stuff too. Who knows what happens? What do they do with the whole bucket or canister of fetuses at Planned Parenthood and other places? What do they do with them? Like, what do they pour them in the trash? They go to the garbage dump? Are they sold? Are they taken off? The science. I can only tell you this. I don't know of any Satanist that, has told me over all these years, hey, we do this just to get the fetuses. But investigate that.
Okay.
Take a look at that, anybody. I think that needs to be looked at. Where do the fetuses go, let alone, some said that, there's been the whole issue of, are they being used in stem cell stuff? Are they being used in making of makeup? I do know that Satanists in real rituals will use a fetus.
Wow. I mean, just the thought of the use of dead babies in makeup. I get your point too, is look into that, and point well taken. Okay.
Another question from a listener asks what you think about the Shemitah.
Oh. Okay.
All right. I don't have anything on that at this point. Nothing yet.
All right. Okay. The blood moons and
sure. And look, we've had some blood moons, we had some stuff. There's a lot of things. I think that they have some merit, but I want to go back to biblical scripture that gives me the most merit. That gives me the infallible clarity of this will happen, that will happen, this is clear, that is clear. That's how it was written. So my stance is the clarity of biblical prophecy is supreme in describing the future events. And the more we know them clearly, they go far beyond codes, they go far beyond blood moon issues, they go far beyond other harbingers. The clarity that any believer can get into Scripture and realize New Testament, one-third of it is prophecy, 1,000 prophecies collectively in Scripture, well over 500 already fulfilled in infallible, detailed ways. So I would encourage more than anything, judge all of these things by the clarity of multiple Scriptures.
Understood. And that's great advice. Very well said. And enough said on that. Russ, we got about 15 minutes left of the program, or 20 minutes left of the program at best. What haven't we addressed that you would like to address here? We'd like to open up to what you want to talk about, what you feel is important at this point in the last 20 minutes or so of the program.
Well, I would say one thing is that I love you guys. I appreciate you. Appreciate when we met together and seen each other at conferences and so forth. I'll be calling you about a conference coming up here shortly. I thank you for your work. I pray God's blessing and protection and shield, Psalm 91, over you guys. But I would say to all those listening now live and all those listening later on in archives that I have one thing to say. Jesus Christ is the brilliant. He is God in human flesh. He loves you. He died for you. The physics of God at the cross transcend infinitely beyond transhumanists and all the other junk out there, and that God has the answer, and that knowing him ends the search. And so I know that you have many seekers and many those who are searching. And listen, for many of you that are searchers and you're there, I was saying this earlier on my other broadcast, I have individuals that say to me sometimes, Russ, I don't believe the way you believe about Jesus yet, but I thank you for this or I thank you for that. Anybody realizing the world's in a mess, the world's going the way it goes, and you're looking at all the conspiracies, understand that the center of all of this hatred of Satan and doing what he's doing in the world is his hatred of Christ. He wanted him killed the first time. He wants him stopped the second time. He doesn't want you to know God. And so above all the dark stuff we talked about, a lot of, you know, ugly stuff, even the, you know, the sex of the dead issues and all that, it's all real. It's all growing. It's going to continue. The world's going to be shocked at the levels of what's coming out. But the answer is the indestructible hope of Jesus. His power to change us and save us right now, the Spirit of God to dwell inside of us right now, depositing what's coming, the indestructible immortality at the glorification, that first resurrection when Christ, you know, raises us up and we're caught up to meet the Lord. That glorification is the coming race. That is what not everyone is hearing about, is what God has done at the cross brings about this astounding new race of redeemed humans that are indestructible, that are immortals. Here's the real immortalism. It comes from the immortal God. God loves us. God knows us. God knows how to reach into us. And anyone listening, the command of God is to repent and turn to Jesus, to receive him, to believe on him, to receive his presence. Why anybody doesn't? I can go back to me when I fought at first and rebelled in my sin and rebelled in all that I was into. But thank God that the Spirit of God convicted me and brought me to Jesus. So in all the darkness, the greatest is the light of Christ and the astounding power of God that he gives Christians, the shield that he is, the ultimate protector, and the ultimate healer, redeemer, restorer of our lives. So in this very end, the most beautiful thing to talk about is the Savior that said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." There's no one like him. All the demons of hell that we talked about fear him, and he's coming. He's coming to bring what he purchased for us at the cross. And it begins with salvation here and right now. And, you know, no amount of prep, no amount of, vegetarian foods, no amount of just knowing all the conspiracies, no amount of just being angry is going to save you. Jesus will save you and lead you to the spiritual preparations, physical preparations to make a major, major difference in the life that you have in these end of days. So I preach Jesus to you unashamedly and say that he loves you. Come to Christ. Give him your heart. Give him your life. He's waiting for you right now. Whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And I call you to come to Christ. Appreciate that.
Fantastic. Well, not a problem. And I refer back in one of your, I believe it was one of your teachings here, the our spiritual power, the five A's that you talk about, the awareness, and that's I think it's the 2 Corinthians 2:11, the being alert, Colossians 4:2, authority, Luke 10, armor of God, Romans 6, put it on and leave it on, and evaluate it often. Of course, and 5, action, putting the Word of God into practice. And, I think you're the one that came up with the 5 A's, and very good advice, awareness, alert, authority. And not too many people know the authority that we have in the Word, and that we have to know the Word of God well, especially the prophetic element, and become as powerful in prayer as possible. And develop our faith, step out in obedience, and use the Holy Spirit or accept the Holy Spirit in guidance, in boldness, and understand, of course, the Book of Acts as well. So you really have spread a lot of great information through your works, through your videos, or through your audios, and as well as your courses. So that's shatterthedarkness.net. Before we cut you loose here, the conference in the third and final conference, I just had it here, that's coming up here. Nephilim Mounds, number 3, the final conference, right. September 12th and 13th. Always a big sellout. Fritz Zimmerman, Gary Stearman, L.A. Marzulli, Russ, of course, you, Chief Joseph Riverwind. They're going to be there.
Yes.
2 days. 2 days worth of...
Correct, right. Mm-hmm.
Okay, all right.
Absolutely.
All right. And that, by the way, folks, is NephilimMounds3.com. Looking forward to hopefully being able to attend that conference, Russ, and really just picking your brain and just listening to what everyone has to say about this. And the importance there, of course, is the we discussed that in the transhumanism aspect of the gods in the coming 3.0 human, the alien connection, the prophecy, and the beast, and so on. So this is going to be a great deal. Really appreciate you putting this on for us, and we'll be watching for more details, and we'll be linking up to that. Russ, thank you so very much for your time. I just, man, for how busy you are and everything you're dealing with, I just want to say thank you. And certainly I want to ask our listeners to pray a hedge of protection over Russ and his family from this part penguin, whatever this warlock is that has decided to take Russ on personally and his family on personally. And we'll be praying for you on that as well.
Appreciate it so much, Doug. So much joy, Joe. Just a blessing to you, and hope to see you soon.
All right, brother. You take
Can't
care.
Wait. Thanks, Russ, for your time. God bless you.
God bless, buddy. Thank you, man.
Good night. God bless. Bye-bye.
Tomorrow, we have a special show, and it'll be a good segue from this show. John Robertson, he runs HH Connections. He works with Chance. He has been working in Hollywood for a long time. Is going to come on for 3 hours. The first 2 hours of explanations. The third hour, we'll be take calls and questions about what he has uncovered in the Hollywood, the occult nature of Hollywood. It's going to be a fantastic show. And then Friday, we have Josh Peck coming back on, author of Quantum Physics.
You know, the Josh Peck show is going to tie the interdimensionality of what Russ is talking about, the Nephilim. And it's going to be such an important show. It's going to tie pretty much everything together. I've been doing, and Joe, I'll just say this, I've been doing some research in advance of tomorrow night's show about Hollywood. And, you know, the connections, the Hollywood connections, what we see with the Madonnas, Madonna, some other celebrities. Of course, she's more of a singer than a Hollywood celebrity, but a lot of the celebrities in Hollywood, I found, have a direct connection to the Church of Satan, if you will. Which is disturbing on a lot of levels.
I mean, countless number of entertainers, you can go on YouTube and find their interviews where they have openly admitted their fame was given to them as they sold their soul for fame to Satan. That's actually very common. You can find hundreds of those videos on YouTube, not to mention in their songs admitting it subtly and outright. There is so much that there is so much that we're going to get into tomorrow. It's going to be awesome. I know John has so much stuff that I've never even heard about. For an example, one thing I learned, the red carpet. They say the red carpet is red for the color of blood for all the sacrifices that were laid down so those people could be where they are. And that's just one small little tidbit or aspect. But we're going to get the inside scoop tomorrow night.
Yeah, exactly. Now, I know this is a little bit early to be shutting down our show. However, I think at this point, we need to do that.
We need some time off.
No, actually.
How is it, 10 minutes?
Actually, we're going to be having to do a little bit of audio or work with our audio equipment here to make a few changes, and we have to do that using some part of the BTR time slot, if you will.
Yeah, not much more we can get into to start new topics or whatnot.
Wow, man. What a powerful program.
Yeah. ShadowTheDarkness.net is the website for Russ Dizdar. His book, The Black Awakening, it is a must-read. And bookmark his website for his content and also his radio show, which is on every day from 6 to 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
And please, folks, understand that this, you know, on Hagmann and Hagmann.com, the video of this cretin out, that calls himself the Warlock of the West, is crossed between
the Pope,
you know, cross between the Batman penguin character from Batman and the late Sam Kinison, you know, in terms of his girth and his slovenness. But the bottom line here is we know you're listening. So with that, God bless each and every one of you. Thank you so much.
Stay safe, and God bless to Russ and his family. Thanks for the time that they spent with us. Until tomorrow, we'll see you then.
All right.